please join us for the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Good evening. Welcome to the 2015 November 9th Board of Selectmen meeting. First, we will have public comment. Anyone wishing public comment? Seeing none, we'll move on to announcements and community calendar. Mr. Waddell?
I'm set.
Mr. Rydell?
I'm all set, thank you.
Mrs. Wolseley?
Yeah, I want to thank the manager and assistant manager for getting the USS Hampton memorabilia up on the wall. It looks very nice upstairs. I had inquiries, and we really appreciate seeing that historic information.
And Mr. B.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well said, Selectman Wolseley. In line with naval tradition, the United States Marine Corps, 1775, on November 10th, Congress authorized the Battalion of Marines to be raised, and we'll be celebrating that 240th birthday party tomorrow. The United States Marine Corps will be locally. Ralph Fitzhello, the commander, the former commander of Post 35, is the MC, does a great job. One of the best birthday presentations I've ever attended for the Marine Corps. Muster is at 18:30. It will be below decks at the Vault, which is below decks from Rungillions. And again, happy birthday to all of the United States Marines out there and to those that have served to them. 240 ain't bad, and that's one heck of a gun club. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Moving on to the consent agenda, number one is petitions for new gas line license, Woodland Road, at Collins Circle and St. Cyr Drive.
Also move, Mr. Chairman, that we accept the petition.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
And somebody needs to spell St. Cyr properly.
Or me.
number...
I'm crying about it.
Next, we have appointments. First, we have trustees with a trust fund. Please join us, gentlemen. Welcome.
Grab a chair.
There's more chairs up here if you want. You can never tell which one's going to be more comfortable.
I would like to start out by introducing once again our fellow trustees. We have four out of five, one who's out of town attending a family matter. Steve Falzone, Bill Hartley, John Troiano, and I'm Norman Soberty. I'd first like to make a comment before we get into discussion of Mackinson and the SEC. Early part of last year, Mr. Bean reviewed the financial statements of the town of Hampton and read them to the public. I remember listening to it and was going through the balance sheet and mentioned the $18, $20 million that is in the trust fund. And then subsequently, we were informed in March of an intent to put a warrant article forth to borrow funds from the trust funds to support various spending initiatives for the town. And then we had further conversations where we've come in here and met with you. And when that discussion was brought forth, we indicated that we're not supporting that, because basically borrowing from the trust fund and paying us interest is paying and giving it back to you is really an interest-free loan. And then paying back any principal would lose, as a result of time value of money, the principal amount would be reduced substantially. And that the town, in our opinion, could borrow money on its own basis and use these assets, which are very strong in helping Hampton's balance sheets, to the point where it should be able to borrow money at a very low and reasonable rate for its capital requirements. And we suggested continuing to have the funds remain as they are, generating approximately $700,000 of income for the town for use as the town sees fit. Subsequently, we had another meeting as a result of decline in the value of the portfolio, and Mr. Bean led the charge on this part with the town wanting, because of its fiduciary responsibilities and being responsible for the assets of the overall assets of the town, to request additional information on a monthly basis that we would submit to you. And about a month after our meeting, which was in July, we received from Christy Pohn a list of questions, which we then proceeded to answer to you. And then we proceeded to provide you and continue to do at this date monthly reports on the financial condition of the trust funds. After one of the reports was received, Mr. Bean was very exercised and outraged over the decline in the value of the portfolio and wanted to have a special session, non-public, to discuss the bloodbath, as it was described. And although we were not invited initially, we were then invited, and I wouldn't attend a non-public session if there's anything to be said regarding the trust funds. I felt it should be out in the open and no reason to discuss that in any way that the public is not aware. And we continue to, during that meeting, apparently Mr. Bean brought a newspaper article and start ranting and raving about my role
as a
representative.
Mr. Point of order, ranting and raving, this needs to stop with the personal.
I don't think most of this has to do what we're here with tonight. We're here tonight to gain some information. We're going to start with Mr. Welch, who's going to start the conversation.
I'd like to finish my comments.
Okay.
And the point was, and continues to be, I have a role as a spokesman for the rational taxpayers of Hampton, which is a nonprofit corporation set up in the state of New Hampshire to provide information to the public about tax issues that we think are important. When I come here and I speak to you as the chair of the trustees of the trust fund, my relationship with rational taxpayers is off the table. It is not something I bring up. I do not make any statements about it. When I've made statements, I've done it in public comments or written articles about it.
Well, you're bringing it up right now. So as far as I'm concerned, you can just drop it.
All right.
And we'll start with Mr. Welch here
tonight. Let me continue my statement. On September 2nd, while we had received a letter from as a result of your special meeting, we received a letter from Mr. Welch, which is result of your direction, telling us basically to liquidate the portfolio and get rid of all equities.
Okay, wait a minute. I don't think this is even happening, what you're saying. I don't even think what you're saying has any truth to it. We're here to gather information tonight. And let's just stop it right now, and let's start with Mr. Welch to discuss what we are here tonight to discuss.
All right.
You're bringing up stuff. You're making things look like they aren't.
I think you just need
to drop it.
We're
here to get information tonight, and we will discuss the information that we want to get.
My conversation is leading up to that
point.
Well,
you're painting a picture here that I don't even know.
Okay, during the middle.
So I don't like it, Mr. Silberdeck.
Okay, well, I presume.
So we are here to discuss. We're going to ask Mr. Welch to start this conversation. If you want to talk, you should have got up and talked during public comment.
Well,
as far as I'm concerned.
I feel I have.
Mr. Chairman and Mr. Silberdeck. All right. We have invited the trustees here this evening to clarify a situation.
To get information.
And to get information. And we are not only talking to individuals, we are talking to elected trustees. And
this
I want
is
to
not
hear,
a
don't
hostile.
Shut me up. You're always shutting everybody up.
Mrs. Wolseley, this is not a hostile meeting.
Well, it certainly is now with your attitude.
Okay, I am running this meeting. You are not. We are going to start with Mr. Welch.
Well, it seems to me that since we've invited these gentlemen here,
we are going to find out information. We're not here to hear about. We are not here to hear about the yellow sheet, or whatever it's called, the rational taxpayers of Hampton.
Excuse me. But that's not a pointed issue. These are elected officials.
Mrs. Wolfley, I am running this meeting.
Yes.
Mr. Welch, would you please start?
Mr. Chairman, gentlemen, the Board of Selectmen, as was characterized a few moments ago, instructed me to send a letter to the Board of Trustees asking you if you would please join them for a meeting this evening so that you may discuss the Securities and Exchange Commission's orders with regards to Mackinson and Company and Warren J. Mackinson regarding the investments of town funds, which they are the overseers or the agents for the trustees. The Securities and Exchange Commission issued an order recently that in fact talked about at one point in their order about fraud. It also indicated that there was a serious fine that was levied against both the company and the principal that I just mentioned, and the Board of Selectmen wanted to talk to you this evening and get your input into what was going on so that they could consider this matter further if they need to. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I think I should turn this over to counsel, who is probably a lot more knowledgeable of the baseline than I am after having read the commission's information.
Yes, gentlemen, Mr. Welch sends you in behalf of the selectmen a right to know law request requesting emails that or any communications concerning the SEC proceedings. Any and all communications, including electronic or email communications, among the trustees of the trust funds, whether as a group or singly, whether replied to or not, concerning the SEC proceedings and order dated September 3, 2015, in Administrative Proceeding File 3-16780, and also any and all communications, including electronic or email communications, between the trustees of the trust funds, whether as a group or singly, and whether replied to or not, and Mackinson and Company, Inc., or Warren Mackinson, concerning the SEC proceedings. On Friday, Mr. Welch was provided with a packet of information to Fred from Mr. Silberdick, but copying the other four trustees. And is this now complete to the best of your knowledge?
Best of my knowledge, that's all the information we have.
Is that true for all of you?
Yeah.
I didn't know whether or not you had a chance to review this
before
it was submitted. The first email in here is an email from David Mays to the trustees informing them of an SEC proceedings. And is that the first knowledge any of you have had that there was an investigation by the SEC into Mackinson and Company and Warren Mackinson?
Yes.
That's the very first? Pardon?
No.
Okay. Can you tell me what was
the
first?
He had called me in the midst of the request by the town for suggestions and ideas, and we were trying to prepare a response. And he said, I just want to let you know this because it's probably not coming at a great time, and proceeded to tell me the situation with the fact that the SEC had done an audit and there was going to be, they had found improprieties with their advertising material they'd sent to other municipalities and et cetera. And there would be a fine of approximately $100,000. The ruling hadn't come out yet. And I said, would you please advise the other trustees in writing, I don't want to pass messages, just send everybody an individual email, which he did.
And he would be David Mays?
David Mays.
Mr. Mays is currently the president and chief investment officer of Warren of Mackinson and Company?
That's correct.
Yes. So how long before this email of September 2 was that communication?
Probably a day before or two, something like that, very close to that time.
What else did he say to you regarding the nature of the investigation?
Well, that basically he went through what they did that was wrong with regard to their advertising material they sent out, which is articulated in the SEC findings. And then subsequently I had a conversation with him and I said, are you involved personally with this promotional program? Did you have anything to do with the advertising material that went out? And the answer was no. He did not have anything to do with it. He had suggested a different approach with different materials, and it was rejected by Mr. Mackinson, and Mr. Mackinson proceeded to do what he wanted to do, is trying to run his business in the best way he thought he knew how. And that was the beginning and end of it. David, this happened after David bought the business. The audit by the SEC took place in 2012. I think it was a few months after he acquired the business.
The subsequent conversation you had, I didn't see that in the emails.
It was not an email. It was a phone conversation.
When was that?
It was a few days ago. I just wanted to make doubly sure that we had, that he was not involved with any of this personally.
A few days before tonight, you mean?
Yeah.
Okay. Did you come to have any understanding of how long Mackinson and Company had been under investigation?
Other than the fact that he said it started in 2012, it was news to me.
And when did he say that it started in 2012?
When I spoke with him the first time. That's when he indicated, gave me a little bit of background in the history.
Did you pass that information along to the trustees about the fact that this had been going since 2012?
I did not, because it wasn't information that I told him to write to the trustees and explain what was happening. I didn't get on either write an email to the trustees or engage in any phone conversations with the trustees. I asked him to do it. I don't want to pass messages and not have all the facts correct because I forgot something.
So we have this email from David Mays to you and the other trustees of September 2, where he informs you of an audit conducted by the SEC at the end of 2012. Beyond what appears in this email, was there any further description to you orally or otherwise about what was involved?
No, other than the next day he said the ruling came. He sent another email, I think, on the 3rd of September indicating that they had received the ruling, and it was posted and where we can go to get it, to look at it.
And so what did the trustees do in response to this settlement issue?
We did nothing until we met.
October 19th
we met.
So did the trustees have communication regarding this particular SEC?
No.
Either orally or in writing?
Nope. Didn't say a word to any of these gentlemen, and no one called me or said anything or did anything until we met on the 19th.
What efforts did any of you make to follow up on the information that was provided by Mr. Mays in his email of September 2 and September 3? Mr. Tryon?
I didn't discuss anything until October, when we had our meeting. And at the meeting, I did make it clear how angry I was about the situation.
Mr. Hartley?
Maybe I can give a little background. I'm a friend of Warren Mackinson. We met in 1992 when we both passed the CFP exam at the same time. And we decided to form a New Hampshire chapter of the fee-only financial planning group in New Hampshire. We had about six or seven people. And so I've been acquainted with him for a very long time. He's a very unusual planner, in the sense that everything he does is laid out ahead of time, step by step by step by step. He's the type of personality that when he goes to take his family skiing, he goes to the back hall and he pulls out a list of all the things they have to bring on a ski trip. And he conducts his business the same way. Whenever he reads an article about something that he doesn't know much about, he files it away. And then when some client brings that topic to his attention, he has it in his file. So he's very methodical in what he does. And he's very conscious about compliance. His firm tries to comply with every single rule that he knows about. In fact, he has a compliance manual. So that if there's ever a ruling to be done, he pulls out his compliance manual to take care of it. I was very surprised to see in the report that his manual didn't cover this advertising, because it's not like Warren not to have it already laid out in black and white. And there's no question in my mind that the error that he made in sending out this advertising to prospective clients was his. It wasn't his firm, it was him. And what he did that was incorrect was he presented to them that if they invested according to his model portfolio, that they would have made profits in the past much greater than what they had invested in on their own. And the mistake he made was not saying in those advertising that this was hypothetical. That's what the SEC objected to. And this complaint by the SEC was the result of a routine audit. Anybody who's a financial advisor, myself included, we get audited either by the SEC, if we're big enough, or by the state of New Hampshire, if we're smaller. So as a routine method, they go through all of the communications that we have with our clients to make sure we haven't overstated things. And obviously, when they came across this advertising that Warren had sent out to prospective clients, they questioned him about where did these numbers come from? And when he said he back-tested it, and he back-tested it, what meant that he didn't have actual earnings equal to those numbers. And as I say, I've known Warren for a long time. It's not like him to do something like that, but obviously he did. And I haven't spoken to him about this, but I was very surprised to see that he got picked up on this type of a thing.
So the question was, once you learned from Mr. Mays's communications that Mackinson and Company was the subject of an SEC audit, and further that there had been this order censuring Mackinson and Company and Mackinson, what did you as a trustee do to look into
it? I didn't know about the audit until I got the September 3rd decision.
Once you learned about that, what did you do about it?
I read it, and I understood exactly what had happened, and I also knew that none of those statements were ever made to us as Hampton trustees. They were made to other towns that he was trying to solicit. But we had already hired Warren way before that, and so none of those things were done to Hampton. So I didn't consider that was an important thing for us.
Mr. Falzone.
I got the email. I went to the SEC website, read the order, and I was unable to attend the meeting on the 19th.
But my question was, for now, what did you do yourself once you learned about this from Mr. Mays's emails and the attachments? What did you do about looking into what he was telling you about?
There was no communication other than my personally reading the SEC order. I didn't communicate with anybody.
Well, you did send an email to David asking about whether New Hampshire securities.
You're right. I forgot about that. Yeah.
And he indicated because under the assets under management greater than $125 million, it would be managed by the SEC, not the state of New Hampshire.
Other than that, anything
no.
else you undertook? Mr. Silberdick, did you follow up on those two emails of September 2 and September 3 from Mr. Mays in any particular way to look into
no.
it?
The next communication was on September 25th when myself and all the other trustees received a packet in the mail, which include a copy of the SEC ruling, the ADV as it's referred to, and you have a copy of that, and a new Mackinson and Company brochure which discloses their investigation with the SEC and their censure on that.
Settlement.
So, Mr. Silberdick, that this disclosure you were just indicating to me, the one from Mackinson and Company, September 25th,
right,
of which you provided a copy, seems to have been addressed to you. It doesn't indicate it was sent to the individual trustees. Was it sent to each of you individually?
I don't recall.
No? Mr. Hartley?
I don't recall.
Mr. Falzone?
Can you ask me that question again?
This letter that was sent out by Mackinson and Company.
On the 2nd?
No, the 25th of September, as Mr. Silberg just mentioned.
I don't recall.
Okay, do you recall seeing, ever seeing this firm brochure, which is 2A of the Form ADV?
Yes.
When did you see that, Mr. Hartley?
I don't know when. Probably around the 2nd of September, when everything else came.
Mr. Triano?
No, I never saw that.
No? Does that change your memory at all, Mr. Falzone?
I don't recall. It could be in the packet that came from David.
What discussions did any of you have among yourselves prior to meeting on the subject on October 19th in response to this mailing of September 25, 2015?
None.
None?
None.
Well, I did. I wanted to make sure it was on the agenda.
With the trustees?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so the agenda was prepared for the October 19th meeting?
Right, and it wasn't included, and I contacted David and said I wanted to make that the first item of business.
And was that specifically listed on an agenda that was
no,
posted?
No, but it became the first item of business after approving the minutes. That was our first item.
So in preparation for, this is the meeting of October 19th?
Yes.
In preparation for that meeting, was there a posted agenda that listed this as an item that was going to be discussed?
No.
So, Mr. Silberdick, did any of the rest, well, I'll ask you first, did any of the rest of you have any communications with Mr. Mays prior to the meeting of October 19, 2015?
No. Just my question about the state of New Hampshire. That was it.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Silberdick, I believe you had some communication, however, with Mr. Mays, is that right? Prior to the meeting with October 19?
Not really, other than whatever you have there in writing. I didn't have any call with him. I just want to make sure it was on the agenda.
And I believe you indicated to Mr. Mays in an email October 8th that you provided, David, I want this issue behind us, and I think we should not eliminate its discussion at the trustees' meeting of the 19th, maybe
right.
Treat it as other business. Is that your
yeah.
communication?
If it wasn't on the agenda, but I made it the first item on the agenda. I also just like to indicate I invited the Board of Selectmen to attend the meeting on the 19th because we were going to meet with you later that evening.
Was the meeting of October 19th, the one that we're referring to now, this was a public meeting that was held in this room?
That's correct.
At 4 o'clock?
Yep.
Who was in attendance at that meeting?
The trustees.
With the exception of?
Except for me.
Of Steve, right. Joan Rice. And that was it.
And was Mr. Mays there at all?
Mr. Mays was there, Mr. Stokes was there, and Warren Mackinson was there.
Okay, and Mr. Stokes was whom?
He works for Warren as a...
For David.
Works for David.
Sorry, he works for David as an analyst.
Other than that meeting, was the issue of reaffirming the relationship with Mackinson and Company brought up at any other meeting?
No.
And was that the sole meeting where that issue was discussed?
That's the only meeting we've had.
There was no other meeting called to discuss that particular issue?
Nope.
So there was no investigation by any of you into the substance of the proceedings involving the SEC other than reviewing the materials sent by Mr. Mays?
Correct.
That's right?
Yes.
Do any of you have any relationships business-wise with Mackinson and Company, personally?
No.
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 I know Mr. Sovich isn't here. To your knowledge, does he?
To my knowledge, he doesn't either.
or with any such relationship business-wise with Mr. Mackinson himself?
No.
No. At your meeting, you had a meeting on October 19th at 4 o'clock, and then you had a meeting with the Board of Selectmen at 7?
Yes.
Is that right? Did you make any effort whatsoever to communicate to the Board of Selectmen what that this issue was being discussed?
No.
Did you make any effort to tell the Board of Selectmen that this decision to reaffirm the relationship with Mr. Mackinson had with Mackinson and Company had occurred?
No.
Figured it would come out in minutes. I'd see it.
Did you feel that the issue of the what was ordered by the SEC in the September 3, 2015 was a matter of concern for you as trustees? Mr. Troiano, I believe you in the minutes reflect that you had some discussion about whether or not this involved any of the individuals still employed by Mackinson and Company. Is that correct?
Yeah, and in retrospect, I had some concerns, you know, I guess in retrospect about it, seeing, you know, what was involved, the nature of it. If you want me to elaborate, I can.
Yes, please.
All right, let me give you a little background. I guess, first of all, yeah, I've been an advisor for 31 years. I've also been a licensed branch manager for 25 years, so I'm very familiar with the regulatory environment here. You know, the way I came about being a trustee, because for the most part, I stay behind a curtain. I'm glad you all have names here, because it's only my third time in 20 years that I've been to one of these selectmen's meetings, okay? But, you know, back in 2011, you know, I was following what was going on with the conflict of interest and being familiar with regulations. I was reading about this in the Hampton Union. I thought it was kind of absurd. So, you know, I wrote a couple of letters that I guess got people's attention. So anyway, when Dave Hamilton resigned, I got a call in my office from, I don't remember who, but one of the selectmen asking me if I'd be interested in taking a spot. I declined because, you know, I said I like staying behind the curtain. The very next day, I got another phone call from another individual. It was after that phone call I realized that maybe I should be on here just to keep an eye on things. So I just said, and that's how I got appointed to being a trustee anyway. I got to say, the obviously, initially, you know, I was concerned with, at one of our first meetings, I had to point out to Warren that, you know, he can't be disclosing, using us in his marketing without written permission, so I did have to bring that to his attention. But really, over the last several years, guys, so from an investment point of view, things have gone fine. So again, anyone who debates investments, I say put that to rest. The accounts have done fine. Okay. With this issue, like I said, I was very mad because, number one, I felt we should have, this investigation has been going on for probably a couple of years. Okay. I felt we should have been known that this was going on. I mean, I know how audits work. Okay, the audit was probably, you know, back in 2012, and that's when they discovered this issue, and then it's been negotiating. Who knows what the original penalty was? You keep on $100,000 is this settlement amount. And that's what part of our meeting on the 20th, when we reaffirmed, I said, well, I want to put in there that we, in the future, if there is anything, that they notify us immediately. I did not like the fact that this was being kept quiet for a couple of years, and I did say, how does this make us look? You know, that this has been going on, we didn't know about this. Now, we did reaffirm Mackinson and Company as the advisor. Now, but I reaffirmed David Mays, okay? David Mays, to me, is a very honest individual, does a good job. In retrospect, I think we should have waited a bit till we, like we're doing tonight, discuss it more, because I guess my concerns were, is Warren still being compensated at all from gaining business from us? In my opinion, if he is being compensated, then we should revisit this issue, because we should not be rewarding bad behavior. Okay, if he was generating business through marketing, you know, taking shortcuts, that's an issue. The other thing that bothered me was that when I was reading that, I guess Warren acted as his own compliance officer. Now, to me, that's kind of absurd, okay? You know, being your own compliance officer, what do you do? Look in a mirror and say, oh, you couldn't be doing this? So I really feel that there should be an independent compliance officer with any company that we're working with here. So anyway, but going forward, like I said, I think David Mays has done a good job. They do a lot of work for the amount they get paid. I think it's, I don't want to hold it against, I think David Mays should do what I call an AirTran, okay? And what that is, if, you know, years ago, there's a plane that crashed in the Everglades, Value Jet. What they did, they changed the name to AirTran so it wouldn't be associated with a plane crash. I think Mackinson and Company should become Mays and Company. You don't want to be associated with a plane crash. Anyway, that's my comments.
So Mr. Mackinson appears to have retired in June of this year. Is that right, to your knowledge?
To my knowledge, yeah.
Yeah. Do you know, to the point you've been making, whether or not he still has any financial interest from the business of Mackinson and Company?
That I don't know, and I'd like to know that.
Yes, I think we would too. Do you know whether or not the particular investments that Mackinson and Company makes for the trustees, Mr. Mackinson still has any interest in that by virtue of the National Advisors Trust?
That I'm not aware of either, if he's getting any compensation on that.
And are any of the rest of you aware?
I don't believe he does.
I'm not aware. I will say that David indicated, because I said, is Warren paying the penalty? And he said, we have an obligation to pay him. I don't know what the terms were, the purchase and sale of the business, and whether there's a balance due him as part of the purchase price. My understanding that will be deducted from it. But that's all. I don't know any more than that.
If I may, Mr. Gerald, just to perhaps refresh your memory, I know I did read in the requested information that you provided, Mr. Silberdick, that Mr. Mays did write that there is an income stream to Mr. Mackinson, and that somehow is being worked out on this fine, and that is in the information that Attorney Gerald requested from you, and I did read that. I'm looking now. I'll bring it up later, but there is an income stream, obviously, if you're going to be negotiating payment of that penalty. Thank you, sir.
And Mr. Troiano, I know you had sent an email to Mr. Welch, which indicated that rest assured, if Mr. Mackinson was still tied to the company in any way, there would have been some trustees who would not have reaffirmed that relationship. Is that right?
Yes.
And I guess you would have been one of them?
Exactly. Right.
And I guess there are others as well.
I can't speak for the others, but yeah.
Are any of the rest of you concerned about that, if there is a continuing tie between Warren Mackinson and Mackinson and Company? Would that concern any of you in terms of continuing your relationship?
I am.
Mr. Silberdick?
I would need to know what that relationship is. If it's part of a purchase price balance that's owed him versus getting royalties or some other commission or something, I need to know that.
Mr. Hartley?
Judge.
No problem.
All right, so I guess that question still needs to be asked of Mackinson and Company, though, whether there is a royalty stream or whether there is some payment still to be made, and for what reason. Isn't that right? Still needs to be asked.
Yes.
Mr. Hartley, still needs to be asked.
I don't think it needs to be asked. That's a private transaction between Mr. Mays and Mr. Mackinson. I don't think it has anything to do with the trustees.
Mr. Silberdick, that's still to be asked, isn't it?
Well, we can ask it, but I don't think it's going to affect our relationship is with David Mays and the other four people that I understand work in that firm who are servicing Hampton Investments. And I will ask it, but I would be pretty sure there's some financial obligation between David Mays and Warren Mackinson to pay for his ownership. But I don't.
Gerald, and just to David Mays emailed you, Mr. Silberdick, on October 8th at 9:42 a.m., and to quote virtually identically to what I'm reading, the company is paying the fine to ensure compliance, but the payments are being offset against certain obligations
the firm has to warrant stemming from the company sale. So there is, in fact, an income stream. And
there's
Mr. Mackinson is enjoying an income stream from the firm.
Let's let...
Thank you.
Are you finished?
Just a few more. In terms of the Mr. Mays's involvement, how many employees do you understand that Mackinson Company has, managerial employees?
I think he and Steve Stokes are the two principals of the firm. I don't know anything about Steven's equity ownership. I doubt he has. I think David owns 100% of the company. Steven's an executive with it. Jared Brock is an analyst, and there are two ladies working in the office, Linda and Carol, as far as I know. Does anybody else? I'm not aware of.
Sounds like five.
That sounds like five to me, and I think it was in their firm material. They described their personnel and their qualifications.
Now, Mr. Mays, as I understand it from their website, has been associated with the Mackinson Company since 2008. Does that sound right?
Yes.
Yeah.
And so have you, since you have been trustees, each of you, has he been the person you've seen more of than Warren Mackinson?
Yes.
Yeah, he's been the one who's been doing the actual trading and the investments for the trustees.
And has that been the case since 2011 when the trustees hired Mackinson after the competitive process?
Yeah. Warren was always the front person presenting the agendas, and he would give the present to anything that would involve the technical issues of the investments, review, planning, strategy. It was always David who would take control of that conversation.
When you did the competitive process of selection of the investment advisor, after the AG's office had its proceedings, did Mr. Mays present the bid, so-called?
No, it was Mr. Mackinson presented the bid. He was there, but Mackinson did all the presentation.
Mr. Mays was there?
Yeah.
And so you had, I believe, narrowed it down to some eight firms back in 2011 to interview.
Right.
And you conducted an interview with Mackinson and Company and others.
Yes.
And they gave you the presentation that ultimately you agreed to select.
Correct.
And that's the one where Mr. Mays was there as well.
Yes. To my recollection, he was.
That's what I have so far.
Okay. And I just want to say again that this is not a hostile meeting. We're only here to gather some information, and we're expecting to find out some more information later on in the week. One of the problems I have right now is for both Mrs. Woolsey and Mr. Silberdick to make me look like I'm against you is absolutely not true. I'm fully supportive of the supervisors of the trust fund. Nobody here has decided about the warrant articles yet. And, you know, to sit there and act like that we're doing that when it hasn't been decided, I have a problem with that. The only problem that I basically have with what's happened so far is why wasn't it passed on to us, particularly when everyone knew it before. And really, I have a problem with, I don't understand why the FCC doesn't have a better way of letting people know something like this when there were 29 towns in New Hampshire that had a problem. And when you read how some of the other people or towns like Bennington are reacting, many of them, it seems like a lot of people are reacting to this. And, I just want to say and clear the air here that I am supportive of the trust fund and always have been. And I'm happy with the results. Today didn't look so good, but it's not always going to look good. And now we're going to start with questions. Mr. Bridle.
No, I think it's we've all had concerns. I hate to use the word transparency, as that gets thrown around a lot, but that when you met with us, we didn't hear anything about it, and all of a sudden we get this ruling back, and we know nothing about it. And it seems, you know, $100,000 is pretty strong. A cincture is pretty strong. But we all know that was a negotiated plea or negotiated settlement. So obviously it had been going on since a lot longer than September 3rd. And it seems like you guys weren't even notified of it, and that's concerning. It's not against the trustees, you know, but I think it would have been helpful if we had known about that on the 19th when we met. It might have been a little bit better for us to find it and then have it come to us. I think that's very concerning. It's concerning for the other 29 towns that are doing it, and we've heard from some of them. So, I appreciate you guys coming here. Thank you guys for coming here. And we'll continue to look forward. So.
Mrs. Wolseley.
Yes, thank you, gentlemen, for coming in. I agree with Mr. Troiano. Changing the name to Value Jet or something might be a very good thing. I have just one question for you to this point in time. Has the town of Hampton suffered any monetary losses or inconveniences or problems as a result of the SEC ruling?
No.
Mr. Bean?
Yeah, I do. Mr. Silverdick, thanks for the opening salvo. The Monadnock Ledger transcript headlines, it was this week. Trust fund manager under federal scrutiny. Bennington, I thought it was in New Hampshire. I guess it's in Vermont.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No, it's New Hampshire.
It is New Hampshire? Okay, yeah. I'm only concerned about Hampton. And a selectman, Steve Osiensky, is quoted here in the paper. I remember all the charts and data that he presented to us, whoever it was from Atkinson, and apparently, quote, it was all a lie. I didn't even know where Bennington is. They don't listen to me. I don't know who they are. So if you're defending Atkinson Company in Bennington, don't attack me. Just deal with the facts. This has been an ongoing issue. I'm reading Hampton Union headlines from 2011, Hampton trustees to oust Atkinson as fund manager. This is updated January 31st, 2011. Mr. Atkinson is a board member. He's a bookkeeper. He's sustained. He's the investment manager of the fund. So at one point, you voted to oust Mr. Atkinson. This is well before an SEC event. This is well before willfully engaging in any transaction, practice, or course which operates as a fraud or deceit, which the Atkinson Company and Mr. Atkinson have both negotiated a plea with. This ousting vote that you voted on in 2011, Mr. Silverdick, was before 2064, which any practice, of course, of business which is fraudulent, deceptive, or manipulative. We're far down the road from there. Again, this is the Hampton Union article from 2011. Ann Edwards, director of the AG's Charitable Trust Unit, has had to recommend and do some work for your board, Mr. Silverdick, and telling you how to run it, that Atkinson resign or remove his company as the registered investment advisor. And I'm not making this up. I wasn't a selectman then in 2011. And I had no idea about this until this information was foisted upon us by an unknown addressee in a letter to me that I immediately reported to the town manager. She had previously ruled, and we're talking about Mr. Triano, so rightfully income streams, that Mr. Atkinson has several companies, ProTracker, and I'll get to that, and he is an owner of the National Advisors Trust. The Attorney General's office had previously ruled that Atkinson may not be charging the town for services, but the National Advisors Trust Company does charge the town an estimated $10,000 annually for its services. And Atkinson has disclosed that he is a founder of the company and a charter shareholder of National Advisor Holdings, the parent company of National Advisors Trust Company. She also found that he receives an additional benefit of overseeing the trust because he can use it in promotional materials to help market his firm. And not only did he use the fact that he did business with your board, Mr. Silverdick, he engaged in fraud, he engaged in deceit, and he manipulated the data, and he used data that didn't exist, and he used models that didn't exist. And he did that on top of the federal government greasing the slide for Wall Street to the tunes of trillions of dollars of bailouts to the big companies.
So
I'm continuing on, Mr. I'm continuing on because this is your board that is being written here, and it's your vote, Mr. Silberdick. Okay, and Mr. Mackinson talks about his background and his education. And then we go on to the most recent Friday, November 6th, Hampton Union. And you're saying that you made, and perhaps you were misquoted, but that you took the vote at its October meeting to show support for Mackinson and Company. And perhaps you're misquoted, but if you're not, you're here to support the citizens of Hampton, not corporations that do business under these types of ramifications.
Well, again, as
so if you were misquoted, that's fine.
Words here.
But if you're not, well, I'm reading, so if you're misquoted, that's fine. The Attorney General's office is involved with this. There's 29 other towns that are going through this. And when you ask, if the town of Hampton has suffered any loss, we have a town to run. You have a trust fund to run. And it doesn't appear to be going very well. We're trying to run a town. Town manager, the town attorney, everybody else is paid by the town. And we're concentrating on your committee. And we have been for 5 years. And it is costing us money. It's costing us our reputation.
Phil,
that's my answer to that.
Can I interject a bit here for a second?
Yeah, go ahead.
Let's save this whole time. We should not even be talking about performance of the investments. What happened here had nothing to do with the investments at all. And I can tell you, from someone who manages a lot more than Mackinson and Company, for what the accounts have done over the last several years, for the objectives that we were looking to achieve, the accounts have performed fine. So I just listen.
That's fine.
Talk about
thank you very much, and I'm not talking about the performance. As I say, you can't make money in this market with what's been done. You can't make money at all. You've got your emails that have been responded to. ProTracker is a company that Mr. Mackinson owns or did own. It is choose the best practice management software. You can look this up online. Are you familiar that he owned a company called ProTracker?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
One of the highlights that he talks about, and you talked about how drilled down and dedicated he is to practices, in his company ProTracker, simplify your compliance task without cutting corners. Okay, well, I think some corners were cut. It goes on, regulatory requirements have never been greater. This is from his own company that he runs concurrently
These allegations that are baseless.
Mr. Chairman.
It was about advertising, not about ProTracter or about accounting software.
This is a regulatory requirement.
Listen, we're going to let everyone here have their say.
Regulatory requirements. This is from...
But I do want to make it clear, we're not here to talk about the way the fund is working. We're here to talk about these other issues. And I want everyone to have their say.
And then again, for Mr. Mackinson's company, he advertises that his firm does regulatory requirements have never been greater, client notice, written policies and procedures, and document reviews. That's his company, ProTracker. So it continues to boggle my mind what's going on here. Performance advertising and the right way to attract capital and benefit investors. Phocion Investments, I don't know if that's the right way to pronounce it. The Securities and Exchange Commission, and again, ProTracker knows it. Anybody in the business knows it. Mr. Troiano knows it. It is, when you're talking to people, you have to be right on and you have to have the most integrity in the world. The Securities and Exchange Commission focuses considerable attention on performance advertising and conducts vigorous enforcement actions when it perceives misleading or inappropriate advertising practices. The table below presents certain enforcement actions by SE-related performance. Well, who is the first one that's on the list? It's the firm that invests with your board of trustees. Performance advertising is viewed as the output or deliverable to clients. The output, however, is derived by the inputs that produce the performance returns, the inputs by Mays, or not Mays, Mackinson and MCI were fraudulent in violation of SEC law. We're not talking about market performance here. So there's a sister company that Mr. Mackinson owns. Regarding your initial comments, this has nothing to do with market performance. This has nothing to do with the Rational Taxpayers Association. This has nothing to do with the emails that you've sent about different. This has to deal with the law. This has to deal with full transparency and that our citizens know what's going on with their money. You, Mr. Silberduck, would demand nothing less from this board, and I have seen you call people out on this. Exact thing standing right there. And I'm talking about a placeholder by Finance Director Mike Switzer and Vicki Lessard, and not a dime changed hands. And I saw it and I observed it.
What does that have to do with what we're talking about?
It has to do with transparency.
Okay.
And Mr. Chairman, I know this is up in again, and I'm sure the Attorney General is delighted to see it again, but this is up in Concord. It's over my pay grade. I'll have nothing more to say about this issue. And Mr. Chairman, it's back to you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mr. Waddell.
Thank you. I'll just be brief. I just got a couple of things. Number one, I'm not certified anything financial, and I don't have a compliance manual, but I absolutely know 100% that when they send out a prospectus, it has to be 100% true, or it has to state that this is not an actual thing. So, I mean, number one, it was false advertising, and it should have been known no matter what. That's not a, I'm not going to accept anything saying it was a mistake. Could not have been a mistake. If it was a mistake, the person should not have been in charge. But beyond that, the only other thing I have is, while this audit was going on, if we're trusting this company, why didn't they let you guys know it was going on? So those are the two main issues that I have, that or one other issue too, that number one, it was fraud, absolute fraud. It should have, it was known that it had to be known that it was fraud, and the SEC thinks that also. Number two, when the audit was going on, because you did have a large amount of money, now he handles what, about $135 million or something?
$165 million.
Okay, so $20 million, you must be a fairly large client of his. So you should have been informed that this audit was going on, and if you weren't, then to me, whether it's Mays or Mackinson or whoever it is, my trust in that company, no matter how the portfolio did, no matter how well it did, my trust in that company would be diminished. And I would think that that should have been something that should have been brought up to us and should have been brought up to the public. That transparency, again, is very important. And we're having a problem here, and we're having a problem with trust with the person who has $20 million of our money. Why didn't they come and tell us there was an audit going on? Why didn't they tell us there may be a problem? This, to me, and those are the only two issues, those are the only three issues I have, that should have been done. And to me, I just don't see why there are other companies that can do just as well. And that if there's been questions with this company prior to this, there are questions now. Why not just move it to somebody different? Why not just, or at least give a very good explanation to the public on why you're not moving it, and why with these not only allegations, but settlements, why you believe you can still trust this company. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
And I just want to say that I was here when there was a problem with Warren Mackelson Company before, and it was very unpleasant. And if any of these people, because I don't think anyone here was there, they would all be more uncomfortable than they are today, because this seems like deja vu, which I knew about this back at the end of September. I knew about it when you came in the last time, because someone had tipped me off and, you know, brought it to my attention, but they did not bring the letter like Phil had it. And I kept thinking to myself, well, maybe they're, you know, have got it mixed up from what happened before or whatever. And, you know, for me, it was just hearsay because I didn't see the paper. And more importantly to me, I was afraid to ask the question, because I wanted to ask the question when you were here about this, but I was afraid. And I didn't really know the legal implications if I was allowed to mention someone's name like that. And I didn't want to take a chance of ruining someone's reputation, just like we would not want to ruin any of your reputations, of any of you, in any way. And that's why I didn't ask more about it. And I did actually bring it up a few times, but I don't think people really understood what I was talking about, and I really didn't know either because I hadn't seen the letter. And when Phil sent the letter around, I thought, wow, it's taken all this time. And I realize now that all of you knew about it all that time. That's really the only problem I have, is why we weren't let know, you know, why we didn't have that information so that we could support you, especially now that it's all over New Hampshire to 29 other.
Oh, Rick, I guess the defense, I don't know what the procedure is to let you guys know. I just figured, you see it in the minutes, and then they would take it from there. And I didn't know, like, at the meeting that you come up there.
But I don't think we really saw it in the minutes. At least I didn't. And that's another one of the problems that I have. Although I might be wrong here, but I guess that your minutes aren't on the town website.
They're on the trustees' website.
I know. I don't understand why they're not on the website, though. That's something that the people that are here in Hampton would like to have your meeting. I'm pretty sure if you asked anyone. I found them pretty fast.
They're on the library's website.
Yeah.
Not on the town website.
Yeah, I did find them pretty fast. But I just would, myself, I would feel better if they were on the website.
I thought that there's a link between the town website and the trustees that allow you to go to the trustees' website, and it was plainly there through the link.
Yeah.
And secondly, I want to indicate again, we invited you. I sent it in writing.
But you know what? We get invited to a lot of places, and we didn't go there because we wanted you to come here.
Okay.
And tell us the information, and you didn't tell us the information.
That's
okay.
All right.
Now this is how we're dealing with it now.
Okay.
But we did have you come, and we did purposely, I believe none of us went because we knew you were coming here.
Right.
I was going to say, they did have to send out a letter to all of their clients letting them know about the SEC order. So I guess the question is, well, because the trustees aren't his clients, it's the town that's his client, right? Wouldn't that, no? Where are his clients?
We are.
Oh, okay. All right. Never mind. All right. So,
yeah, well, you know, it's been said here, all we ever hear about is transparency. Well, this is the least transparent thing that I've seen in a long time. But I'm not unhappy with any of what happens there at the trust fund. I want to make sure to say that again. I do feel that how will the voters look at this? You know, I think a lot of them are going to look at it like the way that Mr. Waddell just expressed his views. And that's a problem, and that's the problem that you guys have. We're not questioning, we want to wait. We want to wait for a week or two to see what's happening in these other towns. And then I assume that we would like you to reconsider your vote to keep Warren Mackelson company.
Well, we, at our meeting on the 19th, when we had the discussion about this in front of the trustees, our relationship is really with David Mays, Steve Stokes, and the other people in the organization. And yes, I agree with what you said, Jim. I think we were all taken back that we were not informed that an investigation was going on. That's inexcusable. We should have been informed by Warren when he was still at the firm. We should have been informed by David. And whatever reason, it's inexcusable. That being said, however, we were never impacted by any advertising to make our decision to hire them as our investment advisors. Their performance has been stellar. The information that we received from them is timely, it's accurate. They literally have done a great job for this town. And
were we one of the first people that he had, or did he have a
portfolio?
We were the first towns, and
this is what led to the all the issues in 2010. When we terminated the prior advisor, and he said, "I'll do this for free, and I'll do the bookkeeping, I'll do the advising, etc." The conflict of interest, which was brought out by the prior board, was over the fact that he was going to use this for his promotional purposes of trying to solicit other business and using Hampton as the stepping stone to do that. And we were all invited. I remember Bill was on the board at the time, and I were invited up to Concord and met with the AG's office and discussed what our opinions were regarding the Mackinson and Company and their conflict of interest. And you're correct in what you said before, Mr. B. I was one, and I really had an issue with the conflict of interest. It was just inexcusable. He resigned, he left, he didn't run again for office, and then he wanted to submit a bid for investment advisor, and if not correct, the board voted 3-2 to name Mackinson and Company investment advisor. They were at least 20% of the price it would have cost us with anybody else. And we already had experience, not with Warren, who was, although he was the titular front man, we were dealing with David Mays, who was making the investment decisions, and we had a very good and have a very good rapport. He has done a very good job. He's well respected in the community. This is certainly, this whole event has not helped his role, and the Mackinson and Company name, I think, has a big smear on it, and he's going to have to deal with it. And the idea of AirTran to something else is something that he has to consider for their professional reputation. But they are professional. They are very cost benefit wise, they're a very good price for the town of Hampton, what we would have to pay anybody else. And when we had our meeting, and what we looked at was, were we impacted? Do we make our decision based on anything, any conduct, any advertising, any promotion? The answer was no. We had made our decisions based upon a historical knowledge of working with David and crew, and that led to our viewing this situation as one between Warren, who committed this violation with the SEC, and Warren having to deal, David owning the business, David having to pay it, but Warren effectively is going to be reimbursing me either through a reduction of purchase price or whatever way they have their business relationship. And we felt comfortable that in reaffirming our relationship because they've done a very good professional job. And we're not out to destroy a small businessman who's doing a very good job with a very fine professional team, because we have no reason to do that. And when we came here to discuss your suggestions and ideas of what we should do with the portfolio, and the conversation took a different vent, so we were in and out of here in 10 minutes. Other than that, I didn't think it was material to discuss. I know it may sound like, oh, $100,000, fine. It's not with David Mays, it's with Warren Mackinson, and we can separate our relationship between David and the firm. Unfortunately, he has to live with it. That's across the board.
I remember when this happened before, or when there was an issue with the Warren Mackinson Company before, it went on for a long time,
yeah.
And Mr. Mackinson didn't go very easily. It took a lot to get him to leave and to resign.
I was there then.
I remember that
And Warren, he was a trustee.
Mm-hmm.
And he was also doing the bookkeeping for us. We had an outside advisor, bank, that wasn't doing that good a job. But the issue came up as to whether you could be an advisor and be a trustee. And the Attorney General had meetings, we all went, and they decided, no, you can't be both. It's a conflict of interest. So Warren had to make a choice. He's either going to be an advisor or he's going to be a trustee. He chose to resign as trustee, and then he made a bid to be the advisor with the seven other companies that we interviewed. And when we interviewed them all, a lot of them were very, very good. Some of them we didn't think were that good, but most of them were very good. And the cost was a big factor. Warren did it for 20% of what any other firm would do it for, and less than what we were paying the bank. And plus, we were experienced with Warren's investment strategy. He was very conservative, and we decided that we would go with Warren. And then David Mays came along, and he bought Warren out over a three-year period.
So how much more do you pay him when you use that amount, 20%?
We'd pay 80% less than what the others were.
And that's the way it is today?
Well, yes. Yeah, it's probably 78%. We're paying 12 basis points for their service.
There's nobody else does it that cheap.
The cheapest we bid, I think it was 40% of 40 basis points plus we'd have to hire someone for outside accounting.
Yeah, we're going to have some more questions here.
And the reason it's cheap is because Warren lives in the town, and he feels that it's his civic duty to do this for the town. And if you go way back to when Warren ran for the trustees, he ran 5 times and lost because the people who were on the trustees were very popular in town, and it was hard to break into that. They only had 3 then. But when they increased it to 5, then Warren got appointed for one of those posts.
I remember. I was here. I supported Warren.
Yeah. And he did a good job then. And this advertising thing is completely separate from the conflict of interest issue that was going back in 2011. Mm-hmm. This is a new
These
issue.
These are the questions that I didn't know the answer to after I had first heard about this. And, you know, I just thought, well, people are confusing it or whatever. But so we're just here gathering this information. And really, it's like everything else that happens in Hampton. You know, it will be up to the voters to, you know, how they feel about what they hear about the information that's gathered. But I think that's the biggest thing that you have to look at is what is best for the voters and how are they going to look at it? Because they're a big part of what happens here and what they'll decide to do. Mr. Bridle.
The only comment I got to make is you're right. What Jim had to say is that you guys should have been known. And it seems that maybe this Dave Mays person has done you a pretty good job. But he's been there longer than 2012. He's been, as you have said, he's been there since 2008. This is all stuff he should have known about. And with it coming up, shame on him for not telling you guys. Shame on him for not keeping you guys informed. Because he should have. Thank you.
Mrs. Wolseley?
Yeah, just one quick. I have no idea how the SEC works. But if they were investigating this for 3 years, are they under any obligation to notify anyone? I don't know how the government works.
Not till it's final.
I'm sorry?
Not till it's final.
Not till it's final, okay. Because I didn't learn about this till I got my packet a week ago today. I didn't even hear
well,
a
no
rumor.
One on the board
rest of us.
Right.
Knew for sure.
They
right.
didn't question or contact any of you?
No, of course not.
No? Mm-hmm. That's pretty strange to me, but...
Well, SEC audits, they're standard in the industry, you know, so
okay.
they do periodically, and again, most of the time audits go fine. Actually, a lot of managers don't mind them because of it's a way of finding out, well, okay, when we're missing to forgetting to do something, you know, and most of the time it doesn't result in any fines, you know, but yeah, the audits overall generally don't only last a few days, and then it's from the findings they take it from there. But while they won't notify or when what comes on, again, they did mandate that Warren notify all his clients of the and put it on the SEC order on his website as well, so people will have.
So this is kind of an outlier, a strange situation.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Do you have further comments, Mr. Bean?
I'm just waiting for what the Attorney General has. It's as I said, I don't want to talk about this anymore. This is above all of our pay grades, and it's up in Concord. Thank you.
I just want one more thing. I don't care how good the deal is somebody makes with me. I'm not doing business unless they're 100% honest. Unless they're 100% up front, I can go to buy a car and somebody can give me a great deal and they're not honest, I'm not dealing.
Amen.
And I think that's something we really, really have to look at. Why weren't you informed? What's the honesty here? Great deal. Would down the road, would there be something else? That's my only statement.
And I just would like to say that, you know, I urge you again to put your minutes on the meeting. Your minutes on the town website. When I did look up, and you can find it pretty quickly, I was trying to get in touch with Mr. Falzone, and then I realized what I was looking for, I realized it wasn't even your name that I was, you weren't the person I was looking for after I saw the spelling of your name. So, no, we appreciate everything that you do. Do you have gentlemen have any more comments?
Well, I will say this. We will take your suggestion about making it easier to have the minutes on the town's website into consideration at our next meeting in January. We also have in our agenda, because I've sent out the criteria, that we're going to have more of a formal review of Mackinson and Company as part of our, we haven't gone out for bid for a number of years and just want to have that discussion, and that's on our agenda as well. So in a way, we are hearing what you have to say. We're also reconsidering any time we want, we can reconsider the issue, but we are having it on our agenda.
But we appreciate
what
it.
What meeting did you say, Norm?
The January 21st, I believe, our next meeting.
That sounds right.
And we saw that in doing some research, we noticed that you can reconsider any time you feel fit to do that. So thank you for coming in tonight.
Okay.
Thank you. Next, we have Diana Martin. How are you this evening, Diana?
I remembered my glasses tonight, so I So first, we're going to talk about the monthly report, correct? So for parks maintenance, I've had great employees this year, and they've been keeping up with the lining of the fields for soccer, softball, and flag football. The playgrounds are all examined each week, and the fly bars raked out evenly every couple of days. True Green Chem Lawn has completed their maintenance program for the town hall, gazebo, and tuck field for the season. We've been picking up trash at all the parks. I've also been working on the last warrant article for this year, which is the replacing of the siding of the Suck building. The parks group got the fields ready for all the seasons, including the setup of equipment for boxes, the equipment boxes, and the schedules for flag football and the field markers. And the flag football season, which has been excellent this year, is actually ending next weekend. We're going to have our big Super Bowl party on Sunday if anyone wants to come down and grab a burger and watch some good football. We've set up a senior paint party for December 2nd at noon. This class will be held at the Tuck Building and will cost $25 per person. Each participant will be able to create a masterpiece within 2 hours and no experience necessary. The parks crew picked up most of the trash barrels from the different parks and from the parking lots to end the season. We only have a few left for the Eaton Park, what I'm talking about the Ashworth Ave parking lot. And then for parking lots, Victor Marco and the parking lot crew have been excellent this season. So far, the lots have made, and this is kind of a couple weeks old now, but they made $579,466. There are still 4 concerts to go. And in last year at the same time, we had made $515,391, so we're about $64,000 above last year. So we've had a great season in the parking lots. And we also have a great system in place for picking up trash there, and we've been trash-free all season, so that's been great too. For recreation programs, we have scheduled the fields for use for the men's softball, flag football, football, and soccer season, and all those sports are winding down now. We had one of the best camp seasons yet. We had a great staff this year at Tuck Field, and all the camps were full, all the weeks were full, and we got nothing but compliments on how much fun the children had, and we had a lot of repeat customers. Our co-rec softball league and men's softball league for the summer are both finished, and we've had banquets for both of those, which was a lot of fun. We put together a 5K road race called the Kids Run the World 5K, which we had scheduled for June, and I don't know if you remember this happening, but in June, that particular day, we had torrential weather. It was really, really windy, so we had to reschedule the race for August due to the poor weather conditions. But we had a great race, and we had a lot of participants, and it was a lot of fun. The K-2 sports program is underway, and we're now into our second phase of 5 phases of the program, which is now we've learned to play basketball. We started our Senior Citizen Club up again for the year in September. Art with Mrs. A had started again for the season. And we offered a theater camp for Halloween. It was the Halloween time frame, and that was very popular, with the show being done at the Old Salt as usual. We offered a family pumpkin carving evening for Halloween this year, and it went out over great. It was actually so popular that we almost had to remove it from the Tuck building and put it somewhere else because it wasn't big enough space. We've done all the planning and are taking registration now for a number of trips. We do have New York City day trip coming up on November 21st, but that trip is full. But we do have openings for the Portland Symphony Magic of Christmas on December 12th, Freeport Shopping Trip on November 18th, theater, we have Dancing in the Streets in March 30th, Disney on Ice 100 Years on February 21st, and men's basketball, which has started and runs through the school year. We have also implemented the Below programs, and they all went really well this summer and fall. These included the Strawberry Fest that we run with the Hampton Firefighters, surf lessons, archery lessons, challenger soccer, Granite State Track and Field, Lego Robotics, Theater Camp, Warrior Hoop, Tennis Lessons, Let's Get Moving Yoga for Kids, and Metro Rock, which is rock climbing, which is going to continue through the rest of the year. We have ongoing programs running right now that we're taking registration for or that we just want you to know about, which include Bingo, Bone Builders, Bridge, Hampton Walkers, and there are two types of yoga classes for adults. We've set up and are taking registration for the Hampton Rec Ski and Ride program and the Loco League, and the Loco League is the high school basketball, rec basketball league. We've run a number of trips, including Cinderella, Sister Act, Oxford Casino, Saturday Night Fever, and Dream Girls. And we put together all of our holiday activities. Torah Lights will be held on December 15th and 16th, and we'll have two rides each of those nights to view all the lights. We'll also be hosting our tree lighting ceremony on December 4th. That will start at 6:30 with the horse-drawn rides, and then we're going to light the tree up at 7 o'clock. We'll also have the local vendors and the horse-drawn rides, the cartoon characters, and of course Santa Claus. And then we're gearing up for the parade on December 5th, which starts at 1 o'clock.
Thank you. Mr. Waddell.
Excellent.
Thanks.
That was lots of stuff going on.
Yeah, very busy. Very busy.
I trust you.
Thank you.
Mr. Bridle.
Yeah, it's good to see all the stuff you do. I was saddened to see that we didn't do the Apple Fest this year, but I know it wasn't your fault.
Right.
It was due to other organizations that didn't. I know our seniors like that.
Yeah.
It's always a good time. And it's also good. The tree lighting is a wonderful event.
Yeah.
For those that haven't been to that before, it's a great time to go out and just meet people around town and be in the downtown area. And also, not only do we have the Christmas parade on that Saturday, but that the rec department's going to be highlighted in that.
Yes.
Not as a parade marshals, but as highlighted as one of the good organizations in town that does a lot for the town. So.
We got a pretty cool float which starting to put together, too.
Very good, very good. I know there's at least two or three more concerts at the casino, I believe.
I think there's four.
Four. I know, yep. Trace Atkins is there next week, and that'll be sold out. So that, I know the parking lot this past weekend was very busy. So it's with having the businesses open longer down there with the casino and stuff like that, we kind of get a little extra benefit from that from you doing it.
It's been great, actually.
So, we appreciate all you do.
Thank you.
What happened to the Apple Fest?
Nita Nemchik had some things going on in her life, and she wasn't able to work on it with us this year, and it's a big undertaking, and she does a lot of it. So we're just skipping this year, and we'll probably hopefully try and bring something like that back next year.
Yeah. I heard so many people complaining about when they went over to the different places where they were picking apples, about how expensive it was.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it was unbelievable, you know, how you can ruin a good thing.
Well, it's fine. If you ever went to the Apple Fest, it's really kind of neat because you have this room full of seniors that are getting every bit of sugar they can out of apples. And most of them don't get just one. They get a dessert to go home too, but it's good to see the people, and they enjoyed seeing it. And Nita felt real bad that she wasn't able to put that on this year. But I heard from a number of seniors, I go, there's no Apple Fest this year. And I could just, being one that has served ice cream and apple pie and stuff there, I know all the faces that would come to it faithfully every year. So yeah. Hopefully we'll do it again next year.
Right. Mrs. Wolseley.
Excellent.
report, as usual, but great news on the parking lot revenue. That's really going up.
It really is. And last year was the first year that we didn't actually make more money than the year before, and I was like, oh, you know, because I'm competitive.
Great.
And I wanna, so this year we've overshot that.
Be interesting to see the final figure.
Yeah.
Very nice job.
What is the figure right now?
64,000 higher.
It's 64,000 higher than last year,
so
but it's 579,466. And that was like a couple weeks ago, so we still have some concert money that hasn't been added to that figure yet.
Yeah, that goes to show you that is such a big town asset.
It really is.
And on Ashworth Avenue, you know, I saw it referred to in the paper as crappy Ashworth Avenue, when that's one of the most valuable streets that the town of Hampton, we're one of the biggest stakeholders there on that street right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, we really are.
Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director, it's an absolute pleasure to hear your brief tonight. You do wonderful, wonderful work.
Thank you.
And you epitomize the spirit and collective good time and hard work that the citizens of Hampton do. So keep up the good work, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming in tonight. We appreciate it.
Do you still want to hear about my warrant articles?
Of course.
That's a good idea.
I made you a slideshow, but I promise I'm not going to read every single thing on that. I just wanted to get across the stuff that we do. And if I could get it to start, I would play it for you. Maybe Brian will start it for me.
Oh.
It was working.
The joys of technology.
Yeah, here comes the reinforcements.
What's wrong, Brian? I have two warrant articles. I'll start with that.
I'm just going to get some files.
Yeah, I don't know why, because it was on. We left it on.
It's not happy.
Technically challenged. Press the power button.
Whoa.
Wait.
I think it's right there.
Come on. So why did that? Why did
I don't know. It must have, well, because we shot it. Just got to warm up.
Nice. So I'll start by saying that I do have two warrant articles this year.
There you go.
And if I could find the warrant article, I'd read it to you. One is to make one of our employees, a part-time employee, a full-time employee in the Parks Department. We need a Parks Foreman. And the other one will be from the Recreation Infrastructure Revenue Fund. It's taking a long time, Brian. I don't have a copy of the other warrant article. All right. PowerPoint not responding. There we go. All right. There we go.
Good help, Brian.
Good job, Brian.
Unfortunately, it won't click. There we go. So the first warrant article is for a full-time parks and recreation foreman. And shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $43,368 for the purpose of changing the parks foreman position in the Parks and Recreation Department from a part-time to a permanent year-round full-time position? With the growth of the town, the play season's lengthening, and the growing demands on the recreation infrastructure, the park's foreman cannot do all that is required in the current limited schedule. This appropriation will fund the salary and all benefits of the new full-time position. If the warrant article passes, the amount of $22,452 appropriated for the operating budget for the park's foreman position as part-time will not be spent from the appropriation. So I just have a little history here about the Parks Department. I started my job here in 1993. I started my job as the director in 96, but I saw what was going on here with the parks. And at that time, we had a seasonal foreman that worked from April 1st to September 1st, and he had about 5 part-time seasonal employees. This time, the Tuck Building was only used for camp, and there was no fall or winter programming. So there wasn't much use down there. In 99, we got a full-time parks foreman, and he led the seasonal employees. At this time, the programs were expanding and the duties were growing. And there was need for someone down at the parks in the fall and the winter months to prepare the ball fields and to clear the snow from the Kids Kingdom playground as it gets year-round use now. And they cleared from the other buildings, including this one. In 2001, the Tuck Building was demolished and we got a new building in its place. The building now has heat and we started using that building year-round for programming. In 2007, the full-time parks employee position was eliminated and some seasonal employee money was sent to the DPW for a mowing contract. So the Parks Department was now back to seasonal hours. In 2008 and 9, in that time, the budget was increasing as far as hours for the parks employees. So I was getting them to be able to work more hours spread out throughout the year. And then in 2010, Bob Fuller rose from a seasonal employee to a seasonal foreman with the retirement of Al Mason. At this time, we had 3 employees in the Parks Department, one working seasonally in the spring and fall, and the others working approximately 30 hours spring through fall, and Bob working a few hours in January through April, then working seasonally throughout the summer, which means 40 hours throughout the summer and fall. And then in 2015, the Affordable Care Act was introduced, and we had to make changes to our workforce. So we now have 2 parks employees that change from seasonal to part-time. So at this point, those 2 employees are working 28 hours a week for the majority of the year. But with the growth of the town and the longer sports season, added programmings and more use of the fields and facilities, we're back to less hours and more duties to perform. So many of the jobs that need to get done in the Parks Department right now haven't gotten done this year. This just is to show how much square acreage of parks that we have. We have 21 square acreage of playing fields, parks, skateboard parks, all of that we maintain. And then this is a graph that shows, if you look at this left-hand side over here, that's actually number of participants. So you can see that March through October is really the major time that we have people using the fields. We do have them using them in November and December. And this is a little bit older of a graph. I didn't put in, this is field usage pretty much. I didn't put in January, February, March, where we now are using the Tuck Building as well. And again, like I said, the Kids Kingdom, the skateboard park, the inline hockey rink, those all kind of get used in the winter if we have good weather. So there's a need for someone to be down there to maintain that stuff. So this is the part where I said I'm not going to read everything to you. I don't expect you to read it, but the parks, these are the parks duties that they have. They are cleaning, they're mopping, they're washing things, they're doing trash, they're restoring paper goods in the Tuck Building, they're vacuuming, they're setting up for programs Monday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. They walk Tuck Field and Eaton Park and they pick up trash, and then they go over to the basketball courts and tennis courts and they clean out those. They go to the different locations where we have the recycling bin and trash barrels all around the town and pick those up. And then they pick up the debris at the Historical Society in Founders Park. They go to Eaton Park, do the same thing. They inspect the playgrounds. We have 5 playgrounds that need inspecting. And Then that's what they do in the morning. Then in the afternoon, they go and they clean the buildings, the courts. They're doing things for us for special events, such as setting up for the 5K road race or the Easter egg dig. And then preparing the fields include loading the equipment into the bucket truck, dragging the infields, filling the batter's boxes, removing the rocks, screening the infield, lining the base paths, installing bases, or painting the fields for soccer or flag football, and then reloading the equipment and cleaning it before storing it again for the next day. They also still have to mow, and they weed whack around fencing and bleachers, and they paint and repair the facilities and anything that happens to be vandalized, stuff like that. And so this slide just basically talks about off sports season. So January, February, and March, they are now doing things that 20 years ago didn't need to be done. So it's increasing over the years. And this is why it's important for us to have help down at the parks. So it's a lot of the same things that I've talked about, but it's things that didn't have to be done a long time ago, like the Tuck building. They have to clean that because we have programs in there every week. They have to keep the bathroom stocked. They have to remove the trash still. And in the winter times, they have to shovel out the parking spaces and make sure that there's a escape route in the back of the building that's shoveled out. They have to do the same thing for the Cave building, the Historical Society, and Eaton Park. Eaton Park, again, is the playground, is used all year round, so they have to inspect that and make sure there's nothing wrong with that all year round. Lou Brown Park, they have to do the trash. They have to check the inline rink that gets used all year, and the skateboard park. And they check the gates and fencing throughout the months, make sure those haven't been damaged. The garages, they reorganize and they clean the equipment throughout the winter. They fix any equipment that needs to be used in the spring. And then the various things that they do are they fix things such as the lights for the snowflakes for the holiday season. They deliver and set up over 60 barrels around town and take them down in the winter months. They take down the flags, check the benches, and seal the benches. They take care of graffiti, set up the lifeguard chairs and take them down and the signs. And then again, they set up for our rec programs in the winter. And they pick up the trash, make purchases for the season, and remove and replace the nets for the basketball and the tennis courts. I'm sorry, I'm squirreling all around with this. This is just a shot I wanted to show you. This is an early morning at Tuck Field in the fall. This is just soccer. So picture this in around 11, 12 o'clock. You're also going to flat football out there too. There's not a parking space to be had in the place. This is how it is. It's how the park looks August, September, October, November, April, May, and June. And it's only the sports that change. Every season, there's this many people out here. And then this is the parking lots. This is how the parking lots look on most Saturdays. And every night in the summer, parking lots look like that. They're full. And then the other warrant
item. Okay, let's wait, and okay. let's do this conversation. Okay. We're not going to decide anything about your warrant articles here this evening.
Okay.
We'll take it into, we're going to have another evening where that's going to be discussed. I would just like to say that I certainly understand how you need someone there, but for me, I'm not going to be supporting this because I, especially until there's more concrete information about how we're going to have to deal with things like insurance in the future. And I know it makes it hard. I maybe see another part-time person there or whatever, but for me, I'm probably not going to be able to be going in favor of this. Mr. Waddell.
Yeah, I mean, I go down there a lot when my grandkids are playing and stuff, so I see the parks and I see how much use they're getting and I see how well kept they are, which is important. And I go to other towns too and I see their parks and their, you know, and how they're kept. And I think it's a really important position. And I would support it to go out to the voters, and the voters will make their mind up whether they want it or not.
Mr. Bridle.
You told us a lot of the stuff they do. What isn't getting done because of the time would be kind of what I would want to know. And I've been down there a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I see most of our parks. I see the two guys you have working down there now, and they are there all the time. You know, it was just even like you said, mentioned benches. You know, you guys go out. How many memorial benches do we have in this town that they have to go out and check? And you can't do that if you're raking or mowing or picking up. There's all that other stuff. So it's not just our parks. We have our little pocket parks all throughout the town. And I know we have a lot of people that sponsor those that do the flowers and stuff, but there's more than just the flowers in some of these pocket parks. So,
well, basically, what is getting done now is the general stuff for getting ball fields ready for play and trash pickup. The other things that aren't getting done are the things that you need two people for, because a lot of times, with only two of them, we've lost like 2.5 days of work now. And they're overlapping some, but they don't overlap all the time because we have to have people down there Monday through Sunday. We have to have someone down there every day of the week. So there's a lot of jobs that two people need to do that aren't getting done. For example, we have a Kids Kingdom sign that needs to go up at the playground. We have a sign for the parking lot down at Church Street that needs to go up. That hasn't gone up yet. We have new playground equipment that we just got this year to replace on the Kids Kingdom playground that hasn't gotten done yet because they just haven't had the time. They'll have a little bit of time. Balls over, and that's when they'll start to do some of these jobs when they're together, because they're two-man jobs.
And like you said, both employees are only 28 hours.
Right.
And because the schedule is so spread out over the week,
right,
there are very few times that they are together.
Right.
And I agree with Jim. I think there is a need for it. I would like the voters to have that choice. Parks and Recs brings in a lot of money. You know, it's not just the parking lots. With your other programming and stuff, a lot of that is self-funded.
And it's a safety issue.
And it's a safety issue, yeah. Right. So I say we let the voters decide. It is a tough one, but I think it's needed. And to preserve and protect our equipment that we have down there, I think it's about time we went back to having a full-time manager.
I would just like to say I was here in 2007 when it was eliminated. I haven't really seen a big difference. I question whether some of these things could be, if something needs to be done, why can't you bring someone in from the outside? I, for one, am not going to be in favor of any new employees in any department. So it's not just your department. I think that there's a lot of stuff that, like in the past, Rusty just mentioned the memorial benches. Well, in the past, we've had to stop doing that because there wasn't time. And we have in the past, and there may be other things that we have to stop doing. Mrs. Wolseley.
I'm going to get you really frightened, but you're sitting down. I agree with you. On all positions, not just this one. You do a remarkable job, and I understand you need this. I'm really concerned about our retirement and our medical costs. And this is right across the board. In the latest town and city, and I don't know if you guys are ready yet, they're talking about a cash balance plan. Other towns and other communities are trying to address this. The retirement and medical are going to kill us. That's the problem with the employees. So I will not support not just this, but any other requests for full-time employees. If this is going on the warrant, and right now it's just Rick and I saying that we can't support it, the wording of this is a little problem, I think. Fred, it says, if this warrant article passes, the amount of $22,452 appropriated in the operating budget part-time position will not be spent. Some of that will be spent because this is geared as a 39-week appropriation.
That's correct.
So I think we just have to correct that language instead of having the note.
Right.
But, you do a remarkable job. The your employees do a remarkable job, and we're very grateful for it. But in this case, I can't support any new employees.
One thing I was going to ask is I don't think we have this information about what you had on your slideshow.
Would you like a copy?
Yeah, I think that you should give it to everybody so that we can really take a look at that. Because, like I said, we won't be making a decision here this evening anyway.
Right.
And it'd be good to have that. The other part that I wanted to say, too, is mainly I'm not in favor of new employees because I would like to be able to be in favor of the employees we have, and I know I will be. Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Love to get that information, if not teach selecting, but on the website so people have a real grasp of what you're doing.
Sure.
I would like a synopsis and a chop from the town manager and assistant town manager on how your maintenance needs, your operating needs can be aided and abetted with the Public Works Department. I understand that we plow schools, but we don't do anything else up there. But parks are town property, and the segregation of your outfit and Public Works to do essentially public work tasks, having been a former Public Works employee with maybe Mr. Bridle back in the day, you know, you're cutting the lawn here, you're cutting the lawn there, but it's all town property and not school property. So I would like a chop on that to see how you two sit down and talk. And again, looking at the Health Care Act, looking at unknown pension increases with that decrease in the stock market. And additionally, we've got another unknown, the property casualty insurance. So there's a lot of unknowns when you sit up here and we're looking at that. And thank you for bringing the idea forward.
Well, I'm just trying to get the job done.
Yeah,
and I've seen that it's not doing as well as it could. And
yeah.
I need leadership down there. Yeah.
What about the, so you're doing most of the mowing now, not you, but your department, or a
our
lot
department,
of it?
Yeah, we took
or
over.
Or do you hire it?
We, both.
Yeah, because in the past we used to hire it out.
Right.
Yeah, mowing the parks.
We mowed all the parks for a long time. Then we, as you saw in the spreadsheet, we got a mowing contract, but they still don't mow everything. And so we still mow Tuck Field, parts of Lou Brown Park, Eaton Park, and Founders Park. But we still do all the weed whacking everywhere. So, and we in that contract is some of the things that Public Works used to do. The pump stations are in that contract for mowing.
Do you ever get anyone that volunteers?
No.
No. But, you know, that would be a serious conversation to start, because a lot of other towns do. And all of these parents of these children, and, you know, maybe they might want to, maybe there might be another answer with more volunteerism. And I certainly appreciate everything you do with both the young people and the senior citizens.
Thank you.
You want to go on to the next one?
Sure.
Please?
So this one is the Recreation Infrastructure Special Revenue Fund, and this one says, shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $115,350 for the purpose of purchasing the following items of equipment for the Recreation Parks Department: a one-ton dump truck for the Recreation Department to replace its current 1999 one-ton dump truck, which shall be traded in as part of the purchase if deemed to be prudent by the Recreation Parks Director, Town Manager, and Board of Selectmen; two, a new playground equipment to replace the obsolete playground equipment at Five Corners Park, all is determined by the Board of Selectmen, the Town Manager, and the Director of Recreation and Parks; and to authorize the withdrawal of $115,350 for the Recreation Infrastructure Fund. So here, I should have put a pictures of the playground equipment that's at Five Corners right now. There's stuff that's been there since I started my job in 1993, and I'm sure it was there a lot longer than that. I'm sure you've been by it. You live by it, so you've seen it.
All the time, every day.
There's a terrible slide there. There's a big snail thing that's very outdated, and there's a spring animal. So truly, that park needs a facelift. And a new modern playground for the children there. So we'd like to put a playground that looks similar to this. This is all modern new equipment and a lot of fun for the kids. So we're looking to do something like that with part of the money. And then this is just a picture of our dump truck. There's a little rust over here on the left. And then this is our bed right here. It's a little rusted out, but this truck is a 1999. And as you can deduce by the previous slides, it's collected a lot of trash and hauled a lot of equipment for the Parks Department, and it's on the schedule. It's the time to replace it, this piece of equipment. So then I'm not going to read all of this because we did talk about a lot of this already, but basically I kind of said that the minimal amount of money that this warrant article represents, meaning the Parks Foreman one, will go a long way for the community. Whether you play a sports program or have a child that does, or if you sit and relax on the park bench and eat your lunch at one of the parks, the Parks Department affects you. They are unsung heroes that keep the play areas and equipment in parks and play areas safe for use and ready for use. They also keep our parks beautiful and help us to provide safe quality programs for the residents. And in that warrant article, I'm asking for a little over $43,000, which is 0.016 on the tax rate. Then the second warrant article will come out of the special recreation fund. So the money to purchase those items will be coming from that fund and have no tax impact.
Yeah, this, you know, again, it will be good to have this information.
Mm-hmm.
I think that, you know, we have the beautiful park that's quite well attended, the one down at the beach that the precinct pays for.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to see if there's not some way that this could be come out of one of the funds that we have, this type of thing, or better yet, if there's some way to raise money corporately to have someone put their name on that and do something nice.
The one at the
The one here.
Oh, at five.
And maybe some of the others. I'd like to see a private partnership type of thing, or maybe somebody trying to get some, you know, grants or something for something like this. There's a lot of things that we don't have in Hampton, and I wish we could have them all, but I think it's going to be tough this year.
Right.
Mr. Waddell?
How much is in that fund now?
Jim, I don't know off the top of my head. I don't know. But we, you know, we get 20% of whatever.
$139,892.
I'm going to say $140,000.
$140,000. So it is coming out of a fund.
It's coming out of a fund.
It's
It has no impact on the tax.
Right.
No.
Correct.
Okay.
It's raised from parking fees.
And that
Go ahead.
That park down there, some of that equipment on, I think, I'm sure Mr. Bean and myself played on when we were that age.
It's old.
That park has been there a long time, and it definitely does need to be retrofitted. And again, this comes out of the park revenue fund, along with that dump truck. That dump truck's 15 years old, and it's served its life, and I'm sure it's... Mm-hmm. It's time to go down the road with that. But more than that, playground equipment has changed an awful lot in the 40 years since that stuff was probably put in there. And for safety-wise and stuff like that, I think that's a well-used pocket park.
Yeah.
And I think for coming out of the fund, there will be no tax impact on it. I think it's a good way to continue us to have these small little pocket parks around town for the children. So,
yeah, the dead trees.
Are you finished, Mr. Waddell?
You too.
I still say I think that you should try to get some private partnership. I don't understand why a park like that wouldn't want to have Coca-Cola or somebody like that could come forth and maybe help out.
Well, you never know who will come out of the
woodwork
for something
like that.
Well,
there could
be
someone.
Mm-hmm.
Mrs. Wolseley.
The dead trees need to come down, too.
Yes, they do.
That's not in her budget.
I'm all over that, too. I've got some quotes for that as well.
I have no problem
Mr. Bean?
There is no tax impact. You do generate revenue. You work hard. We've talked about some other concerns. Again, no tax impact. Recreation's important. I never see any kids on the Little River playground. Mary Louise is always hugging the equipment, but she's just a little girl at heart. I do support it, and I think if you do improve that playground, there will be some of Rusty's grandkids and some of my grandkids playing on it. I'll be sure to bring them over. Thank you.
Well, playgrounds have a 14-year really lifespan, and most of the playgrounds in our community are all older than that now, so it's time to start replacing this stuff.
Good. Thank you, Diana. That's very nice.
Thank you.
All right, and I'll get you the copies
the information,
of the... Yep.
Yeah, I think everybody would like to take a look at it. Thank you for coming in tonight, and thank you for waiting.
Mr. Chairman, I'll move that we approve the minutes of October 26th.
I'll second
it. All those in favor?
Yep.
Unanimous. Thank you. Moving on to the town manager's report.
Mr. Chairman, before you do that, there's some folks here from the Conservation Commission who also have our warrant articles tonight that are going to be reviewed.
Oh, good.
And I would suggest, in order to keep them waiting, we go to the conservation warrant articles for review.
Okay, good.
Okay, do you want to join us at the table, please?
You want to do them in order, Mr. Chairman, the ice pond?
I don't know what order you guys have them in, so.
Yeah, just give us your presentation.
Sure. Good evening, everybody. The first one we're going to discuss is the Conservation Fund. And this is a warrant article. Well, we're looking to rebuild the Conservation Land Fund. First, let me tell you who we are. Just for those who don't know, this is Rayanne Dione, the town's conservation coordinator, and I'm Jay Diener, the current chair of the Conservation Commission. We've had the Conservation Fund in place for quite a few years. It's used primarily for purchase of conservation land, conservation easements, and maintenance of the properties that we own or manage on behalf of the town. There is currently about $108,000 in that fund. About $46,000 of that fund has been allocated for part of the cost of the replacement of the ice pond dam and part of the engineering for that. So that leaves us roughly $60,000 in that fund that's available. The fund has been used in recent years to help offset the purchase of the ice pond itself, as well as the Batchelder Farm conservation easement. At one point in time, just to give you a frame of reference, that fund totaled over $450,000. This is the fourth year the warrant article has been presented to the voters to increase funding for this fund. And in previous years, it has been supported by the voters overwhelmingly, most often by about a 4-to-1 margin. So it's clear that the voters in Hampton are in favor of conserving land, conserving open spaces for the town's benefits. Last year, this was a $10,000 warrant article. This year, we're looking to increase it to a $20,000 warrant article because we have a long way to go to get it up to a fund that we can use to make some meaningful purchases. The impact to the voters last year was 0.4 cents per $1,000 valuation. So given the new tax rate is increased, we don't know exactly where that is, but we know we're going to be at least double that, so we're talking about 0.8 cents per $1,000 valuation. Still not a substantial tax on the town's property owners.
Mr. Chairman, are we going to be...
We're going to listen to their presentation.
Are we going to be voting on this tonight?
No.
No, just no. Listening. Okay.
We're taking everything under consideration.
Okay, good.
We're looking at a number of different properties in town for conservation purposes. We've been having some discussions with two property owners who are considering either an outright purchase or conservation easements on their properties. We've been looking at significant parcels in town that we would like to target for conservation purposes to protect open spaces as well as to protect our town's water resources. But we're not at a place where we have enough funds to be able to support those kinds of transactions. As you know, we've been approaching this process on an annual basis because we're looking to gradually build up our funds so that when we do get to the point where we have a purchase that we think is to the benefit of the town, we can make a substantial portion of that, we can supply a substantial portion of that funding from our own funds rather than having to go to the voters. So in effect, this is the Conservation Commission's Capital Improvement Fund. We're once again looking for the town's support to help to continue to build up that fund for the town's benefit. And I'd be happy to answer any questions you have.
Mr. Bridle.
No, I think the Conservation Commission has been good stewards of our conservation land. We have a lot of great places. I know Mr. Bean talks about my grandchildren. We enjoy a number of those conservation pieces of property in this town, and I know a lot of citizens do. And in fact, the citizens of this town usually overwhelmingly support this, so I got no problem with this.
Mrs. Wellesley.
No problem.
Mr. Bean.
No problemo.
Yeah. Mr.
I have no problem. We always got to just keep in our thoughts that an eighth of it, 10th percent is an 8th to 10th percent, an 8th to 10th percent, an 8th to 10%, and all of a sudden it's
I understand that completely. We're trying to strike a balance between protecting our property owners' financial interests and at the same time working for the town's benefit as a whole.
I myself, I think, you know, it's great. I think that you want to do this, but sometimes I think you would be better off if you picked something, a piece that would the peep that you could talk people into maybe going out a little further on. Something, for instance, like the Shell station that's right here on the corner. I do know that there is private money that is willing to work with you, and they are willing to put up money. So I would rather see a warrant article coming forward with a specific place that possibly people would go to where they could see that there is some private money going into it and something that would benefit the whole town. So even though it appears, you know, I'll have to take it all into consideration, but I would personally rather see a, how much money is in your fund right now?
Available funds is about $60,000.
So there really isn't very much, but I do know that there are several people that might be willing to help. If that would just be a perfect little place. It's never going to make a perfect little coffee shop or anything, but it would be a perfect little place to have a little pocket park. So I would rather see you working in that direction myself. Would you like to go on to the next one?
Yeah.
We'd be happy to.
So the next one that we want to talk about kind of go well together, but the other one is the land use change tax fee. So just to kind of give a little bit of background, the land use change tax fee is applied to parcels that are taken out of current use. And current use itself is a discounted tax rate for parcels that are greater than 10 acres and are maintained in kind of an undeveloped natural state. And when someone decides to develop that parcel, they're changing the use, and there is a fee that's based on 10% of the market, the fair market value that is applied when that parcel is developed. So back in 1995, there was an approved warrant article that allocated 100% of the land use change tax fee up to a maximum of $10,000 per year to the Conservation Land Fund. We believe that the $10,000 maximum was put in place because at that time there was a substantial number of parcels that were in current use. However, today there's only about 18 parcels in Hampton that are greater than 10 acres in current use without any conservation protection. So we believe that it would be a good idea to kind of adjust this warrant article for two reasons. One, it's another opportunity to help fund our land conservation fund. And two, it seems fitting that the parcels are receiving a discounted tax rate because they're keeping it in a kind of open space undeveloped. And then when they're changing that, it would seem appropriate that the fee that they're charged be put towards conserving open space somewhere else in Hampton. So we're looking to change it to be 100% of the land use tax with no maximum on it. So.
Mr. Wardell.
So right now it's up to $10,000?
A year, yep. So in the last, so we did look at like what we've gotten in the last 10 years. So there was, for 6 out of the 10 years, we didn't get any money. There weren't any parcels that were being taken out of current use. But over the last 10 years, we've had 21,000 contributed to our fund. There was one year in 2014 where two parcels, Smutty Nose and then a development on Drake Side, that were taken out of current use. And there was a total of $187,000 that was paid in that fee, of which we only got $10,000.
And where'd the rest go?
My understanding is it goes into the general fund.
Reduces taxes, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Mr. Bridle.
Like you said, there's probably what, about 18 or 20 that are left.
Mm-hmm.
pretty hard to take that 100%. I could be fully supportive at 50% of that. 50% of whatever's collected, but mm-hmm. but taking 100% of that, that's an awful lot, because it does, again, it goes back, put into the general fund to reduce taxes, so the townsfolks are doing that. But I would like to see more of it go towards mm-hmm. conservation, because absolutely we gotta start.
And I mean, there's no guarantee that those remaining 18 are going to get developed anytime soon. It could be 10, 15, 20 years down the road.
Absolutely.
So we could have many more years where there's zero contributing.
But I want to take a little more look at it. We're not going to vote on this tonight. Mm-hmm. No, I'd like to at least look at it.
Sure.
So,
sure.
Thank you for bringing it up.
I myself won't be in favor of this warrant article. Mrs. Wolseley.
I support the whole article as is.
Mr. Bean.
I do not support the article. Thank you, sir.
Would you like to go on with the next one?
Sure. So the last one has to do with tax lien parcels. So right now, well, actually back in 1972, there was a warrant article passed that said that parcels, salt marsh parcels that are under tax lien, that they be taken by the town and put under the jurisdiction of the Conservation Commission. So what we're looking to do is kind of expand that warrant article to include parcels that are adjacent to the salt marsh but that are vacant with no structures. These parcels are equally as important as our salt marsh for, one, providing a greater buffer to our salt marsh from human activity, and as an opportunity for salt marsh migration or expansion. So we're looking to revise that warrant article to include some additional land.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Waddell?
I'm just uncertain right now.
Okay.
At face value, I think it's a good idea. I think it would work okay. Mm-hmm. I want to look at it a little more, but sure. I think good.
I myself am not clear on this one yet either, but I'll be taking a further look at it. Mrs. Wilson.
I support it.
Mr. Bean.
I will not be supporting it, sir. Thank you.
If I may, for those of you who are unclear, are there any questions that we can answer for you before we go?
Are we going to do the amend ice pond warrant article?
I don't have the question formulated yet, but I will ask questions.
Okay.
Yeah.
We'll be happy to answer them if we can.
I think for me it's going to be on what the total, I want to look at everything from a total point of view, and you know, when I see exactly what we're going to be presenting.
Sure.
While they're here, are we doing
yes,
the
we are, Mrs. Wolseley. Yeah. Can you give me time to say it, please?
All righty.
Would you like to continue?
Sure. Last year, we had a warrant article to fund the replacement or rebuilding of the ice pond dam. It was not a non-lapsing article. And we felt pretty confident that we were going to at least get the work initiated during this calendar year. However, some unanticipated stumbling blocks have come our way, and we have been working our way through them as quickly as we possibly can, but we're still not sure that we're going to be able to initiate the process before the end of the calendar year. So this new warrant article is just reallocating the same $90,000 towards the rebuilding of the ice pond dam. We're not asking for any additional funds. We're simply asking the town to reallocate the same amount of money. Mm-hmm.
They've already voted for.
Correct. Yeah.
Mr.
Fine.
Waddell?
Fine.
Mr. I'm always for what the people vote for. Mrs. Wolseley?
Yes, with one question to Fred. And should that say, shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and reappropriate the sum?
No, because if it doesn't, if the contract is not issued by December 31st, the money will escheat to the fund balance.
Okay.
So what will happen is you'll have to appropriate it out
again.
Okay.
Again.
But I certainly am in favor of it. Yeah.
Mr. Bean. And do we have?
That was all.
That was it. That's Sorry. What I thought. Thank you so much for coming in. And if I have any questions, I'll be calling you. Thank you.
Thank
I
you
appreciate
all.
It.
Right, thank
You're
you.
Always yeah. downstairs anyway. I don't even have to call. Just okay. Did we want to go back to your report, Mr.?
I'd be delighted to, Mr. Chairman. We do have some more articles to finish after that, but The American Legion Post Number 35 Veterans Day Ceremony will be held at the Marine Memorial on November 11th at 8 a.m. and at 11 a.m. in front of Post 35 on High Street. Please be advised that the Department of Public Works will not be collecting rubbish and recycling on Wednesday, November 11th. Wednesday's routes will be collected on Thursday, and Thursday's and Friday's routes will be collected on Friday. Leaf collection, and for the fall leaf collection, will take place the week of November 16th through the 20th. Please place your bagged leaves, grass clippings, pine needles, etc., at the curb on the same day as your regular trash and recycling are picked up. Materials must be in biodegradable plastic bags,
paper bags,
or loosely packed containers. The transfer station will be closed on Veterans Day, November 11th. The town will be auctioning the property located at 27 Pearl Street in early December. Please keep an eye on the town website and the newspaper for the date and sale information.
What day did you say?
It'll be early November. We don't, or December. We haven't received a date as of yet, sir. The Army Corps of Engineers has announced that it will begin the administrative process of repairing the Hampton Harbor North Jetty, which is interesting in itself. I think that's been probably on the books for a number of years now, but it's actually going to happen at this point. I want to call everybody's attention to the winter parking ban that's in the town ordinances. Starting the 15th of November through the 15th of March, there is no parking from 1 a.m. to 7 p.m. on any street in town. Of course, winter parking bans may be put in effect with proper notice for emergencies. And during that period of time, people may park in the parking lot of the town parking lots at no cost. They need to remove their cars by 7 a.m. so we can plow them and get it ready for the next storm so they can put their cars in there. So, and that, sir, let me see. We did receive a check from Comcast, which was very nice. We appreciated it. We cashed it today for $88,842.04, which was the quarterly payment.
The franchise payment.
And we're very happy to receive that because that will certainly help in a number of ways. Call the board's attention. I believe I put a flyer in each of your mail slots that the 2015 annual meeting and board of directors election for the health trust is coming up, and it would be good if board members would attend that. I think that's a pretty important function because we spend an awful lot of money on health, and I'd really like to see the board members attend that. Thank you, sir.
Okay, questions for the town manager's report. Mr. Waddell.
Do we have to approve somebody to be the voting delegate at that?
Yes, I believe you do.
All right, yep. I'll volunteer to do that.
Oh, good.
I'll make a motion that Jim goes and be's our voting delegate.
In favor, unanimous.
Get many volunteers.
God, what a race.
Let's get the right date.
Yeah, right. No other questions right now.
Mr. Bridle.
The only other addendum I have to your town manager's report is you had said that the transfer station was going to be closed on Wednesday, Veterans Day, but I noticed on the town's website that it will be open tomorrow.
It will be.
On Tuesday, which it's normally closed. Yes. So anybody out there can
partake of, please.
Partake of the transfer station and the dump tomorrow. So other than
Mrs. Wolseley.
Fred, the only thing I can say about the jetty is that the Corps of Engineers is beginning the administrative process. So we're looking at 10, 20 years. I'm not holding my breath.
Depending on, I wouldn't hold your breath on the completion of the administrative process. I understand they're trying to expedite it, but I don't think that's really going to happen. The paperwork being the paperwork. The Government Paperwork Reduction Act means that there'll be at least 25,000 additional pieces of paper in that report.
Mr. Dean.
Negative, sir.
I would, there was one question I had.
If it were the Marines doing that,
they did it. One of the, I don't know, does anyone know about that green light thing for Veterans Day, because today I was at the light store and they were giving away free lights. Everyone's supposed to put a green light.
There's a green light for veterans. You put it in your house so that you have a green light showing for your veterans.
Right. Yeah, I didn't go to Walmart. I just want to make that clear. they were giving them free at Rockingham Electric. And I think it's great for us to keep the veterans in mind.
Yes, absolutely.
So moving on to old business, review of the warrant articles. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, there are a number of warrant articles that were scheduled for review tonight that we haven't gotten to yet.
Yes.
The first one I'm going to get to is to accept the lettered streets. As you know, over the past couple of years, we've been doing a lot of research into roads and what has and hasn't been accepted. And we have devised a warrant article based upon fact and information to accept those streets which have never been accepted, but were created by the town on April 24th, 1897. It's sort of an interesting study. So this includes all the lettered streets, A through Q. It also includes Atlantic Avenue, Bradford, Concord, Dover, Epping, Haverhill, and River. They'd all become Class 5 town highways officially. And we do this simply because we don't have a record of ever accepting the streets, and we don't want a question to arise later when somebody wants to legally do something at the town meeting or the selectman want to legally do something and somebody questions it as to whether or not we've gone through the process. In this particular case, I think probably they are literally town streets because they were constructed by the town, but they haven't gone through the process of acceptance that the statute requires. That's one.
I'll make a motion that we accept the warrant article.
Are we making the motions tonight or?
No.
Not tonight. I believe tonight we're doing the fire departments.
Okay.
May I ask a question on that?
Certainly.
Just one quick question. What date is this Parker survey? We had several different surveys down there.
1982, and I think there were amendments in some sections in 1984.
So we had several surveys down there, and they each showed something a little different.
They're all recorded Parker surveys.
Yeah, they're all recorded.
Okay, thank you.
And we use them actually with reference to the lot of the leased land.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, that's it.
The next one?
The next one is to discontinue E Street. Interesting problem, and that is that when the town deeded out all the land where the casino is now, they did not deed out E Street. It's still there. So by accepting all these streets, which is what we have to do, then we have to discontinue E Street because it's really not there. And basically clears the title to that particular parcel of land. We went through and looked at every single parcel of property that was created on the original conveyance that was created by the improvement company, and D Street or E Street was not conveyed. So just it's a problem. We just need to clear it so the title is clear and there's nothing that will cause a problem with the current owner of that property or future owners. So
these are housekeeping.
That one's a housekeeping one. The next one is the human service agencies. Now, we're still waiting for the new generation shelters figure. I've called them three times in the last 4 weeks, and every time I've not been allowed to speak to anyone, I have left a message each time for the executive director, and we have yet to hear anything from them. So
leave it as is or take it off.
I'm just going to leave it as is with nothing there. And if it does come in prior to, you know, going to town meeting or ordering the warrant, then we'll put it in, or actually the budget committee consideration, we'll put it in. It doesn't make it, it doesn't make it.
Was it there last year?
It was there last year for $2,000.
Okay. Yeah, I just offer a suggestion, Mr. Wells, that
sir.
Our welfare director gives you a brief on that. She's the one that usually utilizes this.
Yep. I would have talked to her, but she's been out sick.
Yes, sir. I get that, but that gives us the time. We can get her chopped. It is under her staff. And when you actually look at this laundry list here, and we did hear last week about the unwed mother's shelter, this really does enhance.
This is an important shelter for us.
All of those are important. And when our welfare director comes in and says her budget's only $50,000, $60,000, you have to include
because
that.
And
it's because of these.
Exactly. Yeah. So I would like to really dig down and look at that and make sure that
our welfare director.
She's next on my list when she comes back on Thursday.
And we hope she's better, and thank you very much.
And sometimes she has money left besides.
She does, and the other alternative, if nothing happens, and my suggestion is going to be to put the 2,000 in and leave it there.
And we have a format that we've done for years.
Yes, sir.
And I think we should stick with it.
Yep. I don't disagree with that at all. This is a very valuable shelter for us. Mm-hmm. We use it all the time. The next one is the amend the conditions of the real estate trust fund, which we heard something about this evening. Up to the board on whether you want to place this one in. This would allow the town to, by vote of the town meeting, provide this is approved by town meeting and legislature, to borrow funds from the real estate health trust, real estate trust fund, and not pay it, not have to pay it back with interest. Up to the town.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
The next one is the town office safety and energy improvements. This has been in before, but hasn't made the warrant. Asking for $100,000 for the purpose of replacing the glass in the town office. One of the reasons we want to do that is because it's not safety glass. This is dangerous. It can cause a problem. Our windows leak like a sieve. You can stand outside in the wintertime and watch the heat radiate right through the side of the windows. So
that's why you're standing outside.
Well, that's why you're standing outside, yeah. But it's very interesting to watch all that radiant heat come careening out through the side of the window. The other thing is that we feel quite strongly, as far as the employees that work in here, that the windows should be somewhat organized so they can be opened when that's necessary. This building has had a record of sickness from time to time. We've cleaned everything in here, and we still haven't wiped out those problems. We do clean on a regular basis. We've done all the duct work. We've done virtually everything in this building. We still have sick problems.
You're going to need screens if you're going to have windows that open?
Yeah, but there would be few of them so that we can regulate them.
Yeah.
Not so that we can have windows open everywhere.
Right.
But we do need some opening to in order to flush fresh air into the building.
Yeah. So
that's for your consideration.
Okay. Do you want to bring that around to the board to discuss?
Certainly.
I think this is one that we might need some discussion on. Mr. Yeah. Waddell?
The $100,000 for the town hall?
Yeah.
Yeah. We're not voting on it tonight, right?
No, sir.
We're not voting on it tonight.
You know, I think I have enough information on it.
Okay. One thing I would like to maybe bring out and sure. ask Mr. Welch about it is this, we had a warrant article similar to this before.
It didn't make the warrant.
It didn't make the warrant.
Yes.
So this is the same warrant article that we had at one other time.
That's correct.
Yeah, so the people have already turned this down once.
No, this has not been in the warrant.
Didn't go to
the board. It went to the board, but it never made the warrant.
Yeah, but what? It went to the board, but never made the warrant.
You never put it in the warrant.
The first time. You're talking about like 3 years ago.
This has been proposed twice now over the last 5 years.
And both times it hasn't made the warrant.
That's correct.
And so was there any money that was raised to do something different with the heat or something like that?
No, not that I'm aware of. We do regular repairs to it.
Yeah,
that's about
but you haven't raised any money any other time to do something different to this building.
No, not with this type of thing that we're talking about here.
Okay, Mr. Bridle.
No, the only thing I can remember they've done here is they added the generator a couple of years ago. That was
right. the
outside generator. This is an old building. The windows are drafty. I think this $100,000 could go a long way. It would be probably pay for itself over a number of years. It might be helpful if we could figure out an estimate on that.
Under the billing 3 years ago, which was a lower rate for gas, the payback was 15 years or less.
So, I mean, that's at least getting some of our money back. This building is very drafty, except you can't ventilate it pretty well. And
that's true.
And there is a concern to safety glass. You know, we're not having hurricanes and stuff around, but more and more you're getting tornadoes and stuff. And God forbid, if this town ever got hit, if this building ever got hit, there would be shards of glass flying around instead of little pieces if you had safety glass.
Then you'd have to replace the windows.
Well, you'd have to replace it, but also who got hurt in the meantime?
Probably most of the employees. Company will be paying for it if it happens.
I think it's something that we really need to look at.
Yeah. This is going to be one of the things I won't be supporting this year. Mrs. Wolseley.
I have no questions.
Mr. Bean.
No questions.
All right. Amend disposal of surplus town property and materials ordinance. This would allow us, instead of actually offering for sale through auction or whatever, an opportunity to take recyclable metals to a junk or a metals dealer for sale. We have, because there's an auction requirement in the current ordinance, we have sold some of these things for $150 or $200, and they just simply put them in the back of a truck and take them over to the metals dealer a few towns over and sell them for $500 or $600. No reason why the taxpayer shouldn't have that money. Yeah. So that was the motive behind putting this amendment in. Reserve fund for unusual weather events, something that we need to think about. We had one last year. We're praying for the good Lord to make sure we don't have one this year or next year or the year after. But we do need to have some reserve funds somewhere, and we currently have zero. So this is a proposal to create a fund for unusual weather conditions and to put $50,000 into it.
Mr. Bridle.
I look at this as an insurance policy, and hopefully we'll never have to use it. But if we did, at least some money would be there. And we're not paying it every year. We could build the fund up a little bit, see what it is, and then go from there.
Mrs. Wolseley.
Too many funds. I don't want to start another one.
Mr. Bean.
No questions.
I think it's self-insuring, which is a good idea.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This is going to be another thing that I won't be supporting this year.
Yeah.
The next one is Town War Memorial. As you know, we do not have one. We have some memorial stones, but we do not have a war memorial. We have veterans that are listed either in the Colonial Wars from 1638 to 1774, and then in wars fought by the United States from 1774 to date. We have approximately 2,000 veterans that are not recorded anywhere, any of our stones in town. This would provide $5,000 to study this. The Board of Selectmen would work with the Hampton Post 35, the American Legion, and such citizens as a selectman should appoint. The sum of $5,000 would come from the unreserved and designated fund balance, and they would have to produce a report by March 31st, 2019, to be given to the selectmen in the town.
Mr. Waddell?
No questions on that.
No questions.
No. Mrs. Wolseley? And I have no questions either.
Thank you. Compensated leave trust fund. We currently have such a trust fund. The question is, should we appropriate funds for it? We're approximately $1.4 million in arrears in the fund. We have approximately $290,000 that we put aside. This would, and the figure's arbitrary, $100,000 to come to be put in the fund from the undesignated fund balance, if the board approves it and the town approves it, to start funding some of the arrears and delinquencies that we have and the amount of money that's sitting out there against us. I wouldn't encourage the town to fund the entire fund because it goes up and down a little bit. Eventually it'll start declining, but we should have some safeguards in there in case we have a large number of employees retire at the same time. That would cause a severe drain on our existing funding.
Okay. Questions? Mr. Waddell?
This is something that we desperately need to do, or else we're going to be in big trouble if ever it comes that we need it. I mean, it's totally underfunded. It's been brought up in the audits, right?
Yes.
I mean, it should have been done a long time ago.
We haven't been putting money into it. We've been, well, we have been putting some money into it from the balance of the accrual account that's in the budget, if there is a balance at the end of the year. My philosophy, for some reason, of government is that if it shouldn't happen, it probably will. And it's just the way things are structured. And if it does happen and we don't have funds available in the budget, we're going to be in tough shape, because this money has to come out of appropriations if we don't have it in the budget. So,
Mr. Bridle?
All set.
Now, usually you have a pretty good idea of how many people are going to be retiring.
We do. We do, and we try to keep that balance in the budget every year. We try to keep it within the bounds of not increasing the amount of money that's there to pay for that. One of the things that we're very conscious of is the fact the legislature has been starting to toy with the retirement system again. And should they decide to take some action on the retirement system, a very large portion of that $1.4 million is going to come to play instantly. And we're going to have to cough it up, and we don't have it.
So have we ever done this before?
Put money in the fund? Not by direct appropriation.
Asking for a warrant article?
No.
So it's been before, it's been done in the budget, or what?
We take surplus money from that line item in the budget at the end of the year, if there is any. There's very little this year. And we try to put that into that fund if there's money left in the budget at the end of the year.
Yeah, if there's any money in the end of the year, I would be in favor. Otherwise, I'm not in favor.
Okay.
Mrs. Woolsey.
Yeah, I'm not in favor of this, and I'm not supporting anything on that warrant that pulls from the undesignated fund balance.
Yeah.
Mr. Bean.
Yeah, we enter in union negotiations with our employees on behalf of our citizens. We have contractual obligations. The New Hampshire Retirement System sends a message to our finance director, and they determine what we pay to the New Hampshire Retirement System. That is woefully underfunded to the tune of billions of dollars. This is Hampton. We operate under a different standard. We'll be seeing increases in health insurance. We get those through our union negotiations on behalf of citizens. We pay those bills. We're not paying this. This is amateur hour. I agree wholeheartedly with Selectman Waddell that we need to bring that up to at least 300 or 400% underfunded and start making some inroads on it. Thank you, sir.
There is the budget article, Mr. Chairman, that's set by statute. And when the budget committee finishes with their work, we'll be plugging the dollar figures in there. And last week you heard from the assessor on the reassessment of utility property, so I'm not going to repeat that. And we'll put this on your next meeting agenda for
the cemetery burial trust fund. That's one of the ones in the articles you gave us.
Changing the name.
That's a no-brainer.
That's a changed name, yeah.
Yeah.
That's right.
Okay, moving on to vote on approval or disapproval of fire department's warrant articles. Mr. Walsh.
Mr. Chairman, you heard the presentation by our fire department last week. They had a number of warrant articles that they brought forward for your consideration. And I take it everybody has a copy of those with them.
Yeah, let's there's take them one by one.
All right, there's a fire department capital reserve fund at $100,000. You'd have to create the fund and put money into it. We do not currently have one. One was discontinued 2 years ago. And the following year, members of the budget committee were upset that it was discontinued and wanted a new one. So it's here because it was suggested. It's not here because I'm doing anything with it. It was suggested. So
do you recommend it?
I think you're chasing the clapper on the bell at this point. Although I have to admit that fire trucks are getting much more expensive. They're now $750,000 for a pumper and $1.25 million for a ladder. And we're going to be looking for a ladder truck soon for the beach. We have to have a ladder truck down there. Actually, we have to have a bucket truck down there to rescue people off the top of those buildings. A ladder truck won't do it. So I think this is a little early in consideration to getting there from here. I think we need to study this some more. We need to think about this some more. I'm not a great fan when things get up to $1 million a piece of trying to appropriate those outright. I think that's a dangerous situation, and you could end up with some real sorry problems if you end up in a bad situation.
Mr. Bridle,
as the town manager said, fire trucks are no longer $100,000, $200,000, $300,000. They're paying $750,000 to $1.25 million for trucks, and I think this way here, it will give us at least some money in a fund, so that when we're building it up, it doesn't hurt so bad. We know we got to replace them. It isn't something like all of a sudden it's something new that we need to have. They only have a certain shelf life, and if you did it over the 20 years, you might have a good portion of that money in there, and I think it's a good way to do it.
Now, we asked the fire chief to give us a priority of these. Is there any priority?
He said that he the priority was the way that he presented them last week.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. And this was the first one?
No. He didn't.
Okay, then is there some way we can do it that way?
I'd like to hear his priority. All right. This is this one, the fire inspection vehicle.
We killed that too, didn't we?
Yeah, we haven't killed it yet, but I'm recommending you do that. Yeah. We have enough money for another vehicle.
Yeah.
Let's start with the radio upgrade system, which was one of his priorities.
If we can, Mr. Chairman, just real quick, I'm against the C note for the fire truck capital improvement.
Okay. Well, we're going to go back to it.
Okay.
I want to hear about his priorities, because I think that's very important.
Thank you, sir.
Could I make a suggestion on priorities? Okay. I don't want to see any of these things come out of the unreserved fund balance, and what I suggest strongly, number one, his request should be included in the operating. These are all operating budget functions. As far as I'm concerned, I take the radio, 9,000.
Okay, we're going to
Wait a minute. The training article, but what I'm trying to do is expedite a little bit and do something logical.
Okay, that's not the way we're going to do it, though,
well,
Mrs. Mosley.
Too bad.
We're going to go.
Just let me make a suggestion. Take the 22,000.
We are going to go over like Mr. Welch is doing.
Okay, what I'm trying to say to you is incorporate the five articles for what are essentially operating budget functions. It adds up to 126,000. Do it as a straight raise and appropriate. Don't put a bunch of nitpicking articles.
Right, is that a motion?
We got your idea.
Yes, I'll move 126,000 for the radio, the training, the phone, the SCBA, and the turnout gear, all in one lump.
I would like to, is there a second? Seeing none, I would rather see the priorities of the chief.
Those are the ones.
I think that if he wanted them to do them all together so that possibly they'll fail, he might have felt differently. So maybe, you know, we're voting for it tonight. I would rather just do it the way that he was planning on it having. Yeah.
Well, I think if I'm reading Mrs. Woolsey's motion correctly, she's proposing to approve all five warrant articles in one fell motion.
Now I'm moving to consolidate into a single warrant article without referring to
her motion.
Just be quiet for a minute. I'm trying to put all five purposes of expenditure into a single warrant article so we don't have a confounded 50 or 60 article warrant. These are all needs for the fire department, but I don't want to see wording on unreserved fund balance
okay.
in there.
Is
just
there
a straight
second?
Raise and appropriate.
Seeing none, we'll move on. Mr. Welch, we want to go again and do these in his order of priority.
All right, radio system upgrade, $9,000. That's recommended to come from surplus to pay for the cost. This is what we interpreted to be a continuous deferred item that should have been done a number of years ago. So we recommended it came from surplus.
Okay, Mr. Waddell.
I'm with this.
Mr. Bridle.
I have no problem with this. That system needed to be replaced when I was there.
I have no problem with it either, Mrs. Woolsey.
It's ridiculous to not
Mr.
take
Bean.
These
are you looking for motion individually on these?
Yes.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
I'm not in favor. It's
okay,
it's
we have
drying.
Four.
When
four,
Fred came here, he complained
against.
There was only $300,000 in that unreserved fund balance.
Actually, okay. It was zero.
Well, thank you. All right. Okay. I object to drawing
okay.
down
so
from that.
So you voted against this.
I object to drawing down from that. for regular operating budget functions. And
we move on to the next one, please?
Yes, please.
And you want to put five separate warrant articles,
Mrs. Wellesley,
it's crazy.
It has been decided.
It's crazy.
I'm not sure we want to use the live fire training words, but because the chief has recommended other words, and I did not print that new heading, but it's not going to say live fire
Correct.
Training. And even if the police department contributes the ammunition, we're still
right.
not going to do that.
Right.
This is $22,000 for live training for the firefighters in actual fire conditions is what it's about. And if you're going to do that, we recommend that come from the unfunded balance.
Mr. Waddell?
This is something that he had as a priority, right?
Yes,
yes.
Sir.
Because there are so many
new
firefighters.
It was his second priority.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Mr. Bridle?
If he has it as a priority, let's let the voters decide.
I agree. We have to protect our employees. Mrs. Wells.
I'm going to abstain on this one as well.
Okay.
This is not properly
Mr. Bean.
Done.
Crucial to our operational capability, so moved.
Yes, it is.
So we have four, all those in favor?
One abstain.
And one abstention.
Put the abstention, Fred, on the fire radio as well.
Oh, sure. Happy to do that.
Actually, on all of them. This is a bad way to
Okay, would you please
them.
Keep yourself...
Oh, it's just
okay.
really
Mrs. Wellesley, this is a serious
anything.
Business, and some of us would like to handle it.
Well, I would like to get the money
well,
from the fire department
Mrs. Wellesley,
all in
please
one
keep... Wait
yes.
your turn when it's your turn to
yes.
talk. Mr. Welch.
Replace two fire command vehicles. Those are the vehicles used for the chief and the deputy chief. They're currently 2003 and 2004 Suburbans, which are in terrible shape, may not even be able to be inspected for another year. They're really bad. The amount of money, which is $90,000, to come from surplus.
Mr. Waddell.
I'm set.
Mr. Bridle, well, we're looking, yeah.
So moved.
Second.
You're back to me, maybe, I hope. Why
yes.
are you not pursuing a five-year lease? These are not apparatus. These are regular vehicles for the chief and the deputy, and I see no reason why this should be pulled out of the unreserved fund balance. You can spread it over 5 years, and I think we should pursue a lease for both vehicles. Do they need them? Absolutely.
Mr. Bean.
In favor, so and I had the second.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a first, we have a second.
You can lease them if you wish.
Well, what about, do we want to wait on this and check to see if this is what the fire chief recommends?
He wants these vehicles.
Of course, he needs them.
Yeah, he needs to have them. The difference with a five-year lease is that you're going to pay interest. You're not going to pay interest in surplus.
Okay.
I would just say this, Mr. Chairman, when the chief comes to us with this, describes the maintenance that he's run half of the purchase price in the last several years on these vehicles, that he's looked at the cost benefit of a lease and a purchase. He has recommended a purchase. There's a motion. There's a second.
I feel he's done his job also.
The only I'd say is, you know, on a lease, you got 5 years. They've already got 12 or 14 years
yes,
out of
that's
these
what
vehicles.
I was going to say.
And they're falling apart. They're
okay,
coming.
So we have a first, we have a second.
Right
All
not,
those in favor. Four. And are you abstaining or are you
I'm
against
gonna abstain.
This one?
I'm going to abstain.
You sure you don't want to be against
I
it?
I don't want any, this. I don't want the
okay.
way these are structured.
Thank you. Now, this is the fourth one that he's recommended.
Actually, there were five, but
yeah. So
six, turn actually.
Out. Turn out yeah. an SCBA.
The phone system, which is $27,000. As you heard, it no longer operates well and is out of commission frequently. Difficult to operate, difficult to understand, difficult to work with. He needs to replace the entire phone system for both fire stations.
Mr. Waddell?
I'm in favor of this.
Mr. Bridle?
I look back to the old thing. Can you hear me now? That's the way that phone system is, and we don't need to run our fire department on that type of phone system. So
Mrs. Wellesley.
We don't need to run the fire department without any of this.
Okay.
This all
okay,
needs
you,
to be put together.
Mr. Bean.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Four. Are okay. you
abstain. This
abstaining
is not the right way
time.
To do it.
Okay.
Replace.
So this next one is the fifth one, right?
Let's see. Replace.
Turnout gear.
Turnout gear.
And then SCBA.
SCBA follows it. Replace the turnout gear, $18,000. This is the beginning of a 5-year program to make sure this gear is replaced before it reaches its age limit of 10 years. And that will be in 2019. So he's suggesting that we start 6 units per year. Plus, there are a couple of units normally in the budget, which are there every year. So this will get us to the 2019 without having to replace all the equipment, all the gear, all at once.
Mr. Waddell?
In favor.
Mr. Bridle?
In favor.
Mrs. Woolsey?
Normal operating expense. You're going to risk not funding regular regular protective clothing.
Okay. Second. All those in favor? For? Against? Or
I'm going to abstain.
Abstaining, okay. Abstaining and
self-contained breathing apparatus filling station, $50,000.
Yep.
That's the one that he said we cannot now obtain parts to repair it.
Yep.
We need to replace it.
Mr. Waddell.
Favor.
Mr. Bridle.
Favor.
Mrs. Woolsey.
Oh, I'm gonna abstain.
Mr. Bean.
Second.
All those in favor? 4 and 1 abstention.
Okay.
Okay, now these are the ones that
the chief wanted.
Weren't his priorities.
Right. I put this one in here because it's a new statute. I don't think you're probably not going to want to do this, but I put it in because you have the right to consider it, and that is instead of having a definite term for a fire chief, having an appointed term. So that every 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, whatever you want, you would have the opportunity to reappoint or not reappoint the chief.
I will not support that.
It's up to the board. I have no preference.
And you're just dropping it in here tonight?
It's actually been here.
So we've not discussed it.
No, this is a statute that they amended this year.
Yep.
And anytime we have an amended statute that's important to the town, we try to include it for your edification and perhaps.
So who would like to have this discussion? Would you like to?
No, I'm against it.
Mr. Bridle?
All set.
And Mrs. Woolsey?
Against it.
And
never wake a sleeping baby, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
Yes, let them rest. Okay. There are the Fire Department Capital Reserve Fund, the Fire Inspector's Vehicle, the Fire Inspector, and the
Secretary.
Part-time Secretary to full-time. Fire Capital Reserve Fund, $100,000.
I thought we just got rid of that.
Actually, we stopped debating it, and we went on to the ones he wanted first. So.
Well, I'm not in favor of doing that again.
Mr. Waddell?
No.
Mr. Bridle?
I'd like to see it, but I can understand.
Yeah.
Holding off.
I'm against it. Mrs. Woolsey?
No, against it.
Negative, sir.
Okay, so that one's gone.
Okay. Fire Inspector Vehicle, I recommend that this is $40,000. I recommend you not appropriate this.
I throw that one out.
I think you can just throw that one out.
Okay. Fire Inspector, $82,010. Total cost annually with other with 52 weeks would be $109,346. It's been in once before, but withdrawn.
You know, I think they've done too good of a job down there. Mm-hmm. Things seem to be going smoothly.
Very smoothly.
And there may be many reasons for that.
You know, so do they need this position now? I mean, it seems like it's going well without it.
Mr. Bridle.
I've always felt they needed this position. For so many years, we went out without our school programs and stuff. The firefighters have done an admirable job, of filling in with some of their programs.
Yep.
They have done a great job so far getting this caught up. If we don't support this one, I think we definitely need to support the secretary for the full time, because they've come a long way. They got a long way to go to bring that department back. And I think, although I'd like to see this, I can understand if if people don't want to support this right now. But I think if we don't do this, we at least need to do the full-time.
I'm against this also. Mrs. Wolsey?
Against.
Mr. Bean?
I would just like Mr. Welch to explain that we did have a change in personnel and that fire code enforcement. Could you just lay a little groundwork for the citizens and what has transpired with our new fire and that and secretary, what's happened?
How the numbers Everything's look? Transpiring exactly the way it should. We're doing all of our inspections. They're being done timely. They're being expedited. So we don't have anyone waiting in line. Things are happening quickly. We did have a problem because things were backlogged. That backlog has gone away. We are up to date. There doesn't appear to be any foreseeable reason why backlog would come back to us unless we lose an employee for some reason, and then we could hire someone new to take care of that problem. So actually, we're running pretty well at this point.
Thank you. And the secretary, the new secretary?
The secretary, if you're going to do that, because this position now works 28 hours a week. The chief would like to see it work 40 hours a week. I don't have a problem with that because we have this person working on the ambulance billings. And quite frankly, if this person's going to be using the remainder of that 40 hours for ambulance billings, I think the money should come from the ambulance fund and not from taxes.
The EMS fund.
The EMS fund.
Yes, you're right.
I think that's where it should come from.
But if you take on...
How would that work in other years?
Well, if the employee were hired permanently, there would be an allocation of funds to pay
You'd
for
do a
these
charge
hours.
Off.
Right, you do a charge, a due to, due from.
But you'd still be liable for the benefits and the retirement and whatever, which we're turning
okay.
down.
Yeah. Mr. Waddell.
The other one. I'm not in favor of the fire inspector. This is right.
Yes, Mr. Bridle.
You're right. We have got caught up on all of our backlog on stuff. The only thing I say is we had two people doing that. We had both the fire chief and the deputy fire chief doing that at the same time.
Oh, yeah.
So there were two people in there doing that. Mm-hmm. I think we can get by one more year with not filling that position. However, I think if we don't do that, this fire protection secretary, she's done a yeoman's job over there. She's brought that place up a lot, and I think we really should look at that. So at least we're giving the fire inspector now that's in there at least the tools to be able to work with it. Every person that I've heard that's gone in to see the fire inspector, when she's there, they get plenty of service, but she's only there 28 hours a week.
Right.
So I think if she was there full-time, whether she's doing it with ambulance billing or not, at least she's sitting in that office. And if a person comes in and they have a question and they need something done, she can address it at that time. So I think I can understand the fire inspector's position for another year, but the fire prevention secretary, I think she really does need to be full-time.
I would like to say that I think that there were problems in the fire department, and I think that their problems are not as great as they were at one time. I am absolutely not in favor of making anybody full-time that isn't already there. Mrs. Wolsey?
I agree with you, and that fire inspector position should never have been discontinued. But we need full-time in recreation. We need full-time. We need eight more firefighters, to be perfectly blunt. We need full-time, public works. I can't go for any of that this year. Medical and retirement.
Mr. Bean.
I do not support the full-time fire inspector.
Yeah.
Right.
I would just like to say, too, that I would like to see, hopefully, that we can get some nice work done with the union contracts and that people will be able to support the contracts that we have. So I'm against it also.
So I read
That's
that
it?
As against both positions.
No, negative. I don't feel that about both positions. Okay. Just the fire inspector.
Just the inspector.
Yes, sir. I'd like to discuss the secretary individually.
Well, I thought that's what we were just discussing.
There were two lines.
There were
one
two
was
lines.
Fire inspector.
One's fire inspector, one's fire inspector.
Okay,
yes.
So for the fire inspector.
No.
Secretary.
That was
secretary.
No.
To, for, to make full-time.
Secretary, full-time.
Yes.
I'm in favor of that.
Okay.
As I said before, I'm in favor of it.
I'm against it.
We could use it, but I can't go with it.
Yeah, we're close to $3 billion in property in this town. A lot of it's getting torn down. We've seen extraordinary construction to include that beer manufacturer up on 12 Farm. These are incredibly complex, time-consuming events. The business community was widely disenfranchised. There was a lot of spillover from that with the code enforcement, fire code enforcement, specifically in the inspection. It has been a quantum leap forward. And I think that the secretary, in being over there, has made the difference. And I do believe that she will translate that benefit of her being full-time, not only into satisfaction of the mission, but also into the ambulance billing. So I enthusiastically support it.
I would like to say that I think that this is not something that I think that we should be adding more employees. I think you're causing a possible backlash for the union contracts. So I'm against it.
Well, I
does someone
want to
make a motion?
I'll make a motion that we do it.
I'll second it.
All those in favor and two against.
Okay.
And so that.
Bottom out, Fred?
We bottomed out, yeah. Thank goodness.
Is there any other old business? Mr. Waddell?
No.
Mr. Bridle?
Nope.
Mrs. Wolseley?
No.
Mr. Bean?
Negative.
Moving on to new business. Number one is the NHMA annual meeting.
We did that.
Oh, yeah. Okay. And two, the printing of the 2015 annual report. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman.
Hey, you.
We went out to quotations for the 2015 annual town report. Christina is recommending that we continue with the Country Press. All of the other bidders,
sorry,
there isn't any of them that met the specifications for printing our town report. They all changed the specifications anywhere from spiral-bound pages to, black tape on binding to...
Yeah, we had some of that.
Not properly coding the report so that the page will fall apart, the front, the cover. We went through an extensive examination. She went through talking to each of these people after the bids came in. She calls them bids, or I call them quotes. And she's recommending, after doing that and dickering with these people, that we spend $5,309.93 to print the town report with the Country Press.
I'll make a motion. We do it.
Second. I'll second that. The one reason I'm seconding it is because they are the only one that complied with our. They're the lowest one to comply with our specifications. So.
Right.
I think there's not a problem.
And what about when do we see the suggestions for the cover and things like that?
She wanted me to ask you what you would like. Mm-hmm. So if anyone has suggestions, please send them in.
Okay. Well, anyone that has a suggestion, they can get in touch with Christina. All those in favor?
Yeah. Okay. I have
unanimous.
A suggestion.
Oh, good.
Okay.
I have a suggestion for the dedication of the annual report.
Good.
Okay.
Chief William Sullivan, former chief. So.
Okay, well, make sure to go and let Christina know.
It's always good
because everybody
to do this while they're still with us.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
So.
And I think that would be.
She'll maybe
no,
be.
No, nothing personal,
if
Chief.
Everybody goes and gives their information, maybe she'll be able to give us a list and we can vote on what we want.
Okay.
Okay.
Very good.
And
well, as long as you asked.
I love it.
Moving on to closing comments. And we're going to have another meeting.
Yes. Without adjourning, Mr. Chairman, I would respectfully ask that the board, someone make a motion to go into a non-public session under RSA 91A:3, Roman 2, small a and c.
Okay.
So moved.
And by roll call vote.
Don't do it all at once.
It's a roll call.
Aye.
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 Jim says aye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, gentlemen. We appreciate it. They do a great job, those guys.